Government Operations Subcommittee on National Security held this meeting today to discuss reports of cost overruns, design flaws, and mismanagement of the C-17 project. The C-17 is principally designed by the McDonnell Douglas Corporation. It is designed to carry heavy loads, such as tanks, and to be able to land on short airfields. The Congressional Budget Office estimates that the C-17 will cost $240 million each. The witnesses at this hearing include officials from the General Accounting Office and the Defense Department's Inspector General, as well as the McDonnell Douglas Corporation.
Committee will come to order.
Let's close the doors. The Legislation and National Security Subcommittee continues oversight hearings on the C-17. The chair recognizes Mr. McCandless, a ranking minority member.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, I want to commend you for the work you've done the past 2 years in bringing the problems of the C-17 to light. It's no secret that I am an advocate of a strong national defense. As a former Marine called back at in the haste of one of these things, I'm a proponent of maintaining our ready forces and defend the importance of sustaining our logistic capability. At the same time, however, I am well known as a deficit hawk, and I share the concerns expressed by both Chairman Conyers and the bipartisan membership of the House Armed Services Committee on the C-17. Today, every weapons and support system must justify its cost, and we in Congress must be given the information necessary to make the hard spending decisions confronting our nation. We have to know where a program stands, its strengths, its weaknesses, and its political long-term costs to make informed choices. Based on the evidence provided to date, it appears that Congress has not been given the information necessary to make these hard choices. And I commend you, Mr. Chairman, for the perseverance that you have demonstrated in bringing the problem to light. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Pennsylvania and ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Klinger.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I want to join in commending you for your perseverance, your long and difficult work on this very important issue. It's true that the C-17 has a major role in our nation's future airlift capability. That cannot be downplayed. Neither, however, can the role of Congress in protecting our national interest. Department of Defense Inspector General has issued a report alleging an Air Force cover-up of the problems surrounding the C-17. He has stated that high-ranking Air Force officials deliberately misled both the Undersecretary of Defense and the Congress on major problems affecting the aircraft. Based on the testimony to be presented, it appears that these misleadings were not isolated events, but were instead part of a deliberate and ongoing attempt to stymie departmental and congressional oversight of the C-17. I find that troubling, and I know you do, Mr. Chairman, to say the least. Just as troubling, however, has been this administration's handling of those allegations and the lack of response to these hearings. Our staff first contacted the Department of Defense to discuss the Inspector General report in mid-January. For the first 5 weeks, our calls went unanswered. Since that time, we've been put off time and time again with the explanation that no one has authority to speak on behalf of the C-17. Mr. Chairman, I understand the Department of Defense is undermanned right now. It appears that Secretary Aspin is running a one-man show, and I don't envy him, and he's now had to go into the hospital again. Nevertheless, I cannot understand why this is the case. President Clinton learned of his new job on November 8. He has since had 4 months to assemble a team and assert control over the Department of Defense, yet he's failed to do so. That failure has resulted in the department's inability to meet its challenges and unfairly handicap the Pentagon's efforts to respond to the problems of the day, this being certainly a central problem of the day. Congressional requests for information go unanswered as programs in need of oversight go unassessed. That situation cannot long continue without this administration's DOT becoming ripe for its own national performance review. So, Mr. Chairman, I look forward to today's testimony and again commend you for calling these series of hearings.
Thank you, Mr. Klinger. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from New York, Mrs. Maloney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and likewise I commend you on your research and on this issue. I think it's appropriate on the day when we all celebrate St. Patrick's, driving the snakes out of Ireland, we begin our yearly quest to drive corruption and waste out of government. Today's hearing goes directly to the heart of the public's anger over government spending. Why, they asked, did we pay $95 million 3 years ago for a C-5B cargo plane, and today we pay $400 million for a C-17 cargo plane, basically the same plane with some modifications, with broken wings? Why, the public asks, is this program 2 years late and over $1 billion over budget? And these questions do not even address the damning evidence of illegal payments of hundreds of millions of dollars to this contractor. We need to find out how this happened. I think the committee must consider whether the problem we hear today about, that we look at today, we need to see whether it's an isolated incident or is it a systemic problem in government. And if it is systemic, then we on the committee should look at legislation to correct it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentlelady from New York. We've got a videotape that depicts a problem with the wings of the static test airplane on October 1, 1992. The wings broke at 128% of the max load factor, but understand that the military design specifications require that the wings withstand 150%, and the I think the videotape will be an appropriate beginning before we start with the Inspector General.
Thank you.
Our first witness is Deputy Inspector General Derek Vandersheff, accompanied by Robert Lieberman, Russell Rao, Kenneth Stavenjort. Will you all please raise your right hands. You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
Thank you very much. Let the record indicate that all of the witnesses have stated in the affirmative. We have your prepared statement, Mr. Vandersheff, and it will be incorporated in the record without objection, as will all the witnesses' statements and all the opening statements of members of the committee, and we invite you to proceed in your own way.
Let's maybe try this with you in terms of proceeding with this, Mr. Chairman. Let me discuss the testing of the aircraft and the riveting issue, and then the static test vehicle testing and the follow-on request from you in that area, and then let's go on to the financial situation that occurred during the later half of 1990, if that's all right with you. I have with me here today, I have on my left, Mr. Robert Lieberman, who's the Assistant Inspector General for Audit in our organization. To his left is Mr. Ken Stavenjort, who handles our Technical Assessment Division. And to my right is Mr. Russell Rao, who is the Audit Manager on our audit work related to the C-17. I'm going to discuss essentially today here four of our reports and then one future report that we're doing. The first one deals with the mechanical fastener quality acceptance issue, i.e. the so-called riveting matter. Two of the others deal with financial accounting practices involving the C-17, and a third is the one that we'll focus on, I'm sure, most today, involving financial practices, involves that situation that occurred in the later half of 1990. And then I also will bring in this wing structural integrity question into my testimony. Now, we evaluated the riveting and the quality assurance program for the riveting of the C-17 aircraft wings. We found that the rivets in the C-17 aircraft wings met the acceptable lower limits for rivet expansion. However, the amount of rivet expansion actually in C-17 lower wing skins was greater than any experimentally justified range presented. The government failed to ensure that the contractor set upper limits for acceptable rivet expansion in lower C-17 wing skins. Based rivet expansion limits on a corporate set of tests or tested for damage tolerance with the amount of expansion actually happening in the C-17 wings. The government is not protected from the possible adverse effects of the amount of rivet expansion actually in C-17 wings by either the planned durability tests or the C-17 contract warranty. The fuel leaks in flight test aircraft T-1 were not caused by inadequate riveting, as speculated by some observers at that time. However, two-piece fasteners were improperly installed in C-17 wings and caused some of the leaks. The government did not ensure that Douglas Aircraft Company assigned inspection of two-piece fasteners to quality assurance personnel at the fabrication level, at that level where they were actually putting these things together at the lowest level. The quality assurance program for the C-17 wing mechanical fasteners was not in compliance with military specifications, procedures were not followed, and in some instances were confusing or non-existent. As a result, fastener quality was inconsistent and quality assurance data were missing and incomplete. Our concerns that the deficiencies we identified are systemic were confirmed by a special program performance review conducted in October of 1992 by the Defense Contract Management Command in response to our draft work. Now, we recommend that the contractor not be allowed to have exceptions to prescribed rivet expansion limits, that rivet expansion limits be based on complete testing, and that Douglas process standards be revised to state the acceptance requirements for rivet samples clearly and completely. For two-piece fasteners, we recommend that quality assurance personnel be assigned to inspect those fasteners at the fabrication level. We also recommended a review of the entire quality assurance program for the C-17 aircraft to determine whether deficiencies identified in this report are systemic. The Air Force responded that additional tests were unnecessary and would create needless cost. We again asked the Air Force to reevaluate its response in view of the incompleteness of the tests done so far. The Air Force stated that the current warranty provides for defect correction. We asked the Air Force to reevaluate its position since the potential effects from the amount of expansion actually in C-17 wings would not appear during the current warranty period. In other words, you can have overexpanded rivets, but the problems are not likely to occur during the period of time that these aircraft are under full warranty. The Air Force also stated that additional study is not necessary because it already had a substantial body of knowledge and experience to support its position on fatigue from the amount of rivet expansion in the C-17 wings. We requested that the Air Force either reevaluate its response or come forward with the theoretical information to substantiate its position. We have been asking to see such information for months. Now, let me stop here and tell you a little thing I found out here just in the last few days. I said to our technical people, why are we having so much trouble convincing the Air Force that they ought to run some tests, run some coupons, and attach 7050 aluminum to 2024 aluminum with the particular rivet that is used, the particular rivet that's used in this application. That rivet is referred to as a 7050-TK73 or KE aluminum slug, as it's referred to. How much is this going to cost? Why can't we do this, and how much time is this going to take? Well, the answer I get back, and we've made contact with a firm up in Seattle, Washington, on several occasions, and some other firms, the answer I get back is from $10,000 to $20,000 to do these tests. Sir, that's peanuts when we're talking about a $350 million program here. And the individual came back and said, well, we could do the tension-to-tension fatigue test, and we could do the stress corrosion test, and he gave us some times. The stress corrosion test would take, he wanted a minimum of 3 specimens that will be tested, and it will take a total of 6 weeks to conduct the test and 20 more days to prepare the report. Well, we gave him our draft report in September. Had they done these tests at that point, they would have long been over, and we could have known the answer to this problem. At least we'd had a much better fix on this problem than we have today. So the setup cost for that particular test was $1,200, and they wanted $200 to test each of 3 specimens. The tension-to-tension fatigue test, the setup cost would be $300. Testing would be about $250 per specimen, and they would test up to 500 cycles of this particular specimen. Anyway, I find this whole argument about cost and time just absolutely beyond my comprehension when we got to that point with this thing. Why didn't we go ahead and put these metals together? They keep telling us that they have data with respect to these particular, using this particular slug or rivet, these two particular metals, and we have been unable to find such information. Now, although the comments to the draft report, we fully considered them, we made very few changes in that riveting report from the report we issued last September. In general, we found the management comments to be non-responsive. Much of the information which the Air Force initially said it had in its possession to prove conclusively that there was no problem was not proved, or when eventually provided, did not support the Air Force position. The key point is that the test reports presented to us since our review began do not include either stress corrosion tests with the same materials and rivet expansions of the lower wing panels, or fatigue tests with the amount of rivet expansion actually in the C-17 wings. We do not know if comprehensive tests performed with the C-17 material would indicate a significant long-term durability risk. If such tests were to indicate minimal risk, we would withdraw our recommendation for more aggressive action related to withholding funds or increasing warranties. We strongly believe, however, that neither the Air Force nor the contractor have demonstrated that they know what the risk is. So that's pretty much the situation on the rivets. Then I want to turn to page 23 of my statement. I want to finish up with this testing issue while we're on it here. I think that'll make it easier for the members to understand here. So if I can turn to page 23 here, and I'll describe the current situation. This is the question of the wing structural integrity, and this relates to the matter of the videotape that you just showed. Remember now, we're not talking rivets didn't have the problems necessarily anyway. There's some argument about that, but we don't believe the rivet problem was was part of the problem you showed here. There are other problems in terms of structural design and so forth. The wings failed at approximately 128% of the limit load for a severe test condition. Requirement was 150%. Both wings buckled rear to front cord-wise with 25 to 50% skin fractures. Additionally, there were extensive structural failures in stringers, spars, and ribs. On October 5, you asked us to examine the failure and the recommended solution to ensure the structural integrity of the aircraft. The Douglas Aircraft Company formed two teams, a design test team and an independent review team, to analyze the failure and recommended corrective action. The Air Force Program Executive Officer formed an executive review team to evaluate the completeness and adequacy of the failure investigation and corrective action plans. The root cause analysis identified three major contributors to this failure: a major design error, optimistic design assumptions, and test load placements. Now, we have reviewed the root cause analysis with Douglas design engineers, Air Force engineers, and the various review teams, and Air Force program management officials. We have found the analysis of the problem to be accurate, complete, to date. Now, that doesn't mean we know what the problem is. Now, the next step is we got to go find a way to fix the problem, and that remains a very significant question here. Now, what is the proper way to do this and so forth? I don't know if you want to get into that at this point, or you'll be asking some questions you prefer. Maybe I'll wait, and we'll get into exactly
if you can.
Okay, let me try to get into that a little bit here. What we've got now is we're heading down a decision chain, I guess, to strengthen those wings and fix that static test vehicle that you saw breaking up in the videotape. That fix is not going to be the same as any of the fixes that are going to go on the wings for, the next 20 aircraft. It's unclear exactly how many will have to be strengthened. They have a design underway to do this by adding some stainless steel clips, but there's some real concerns that those clips cannot be put in properly, and that'll lead to long-term corrosion problems and so forth. But so you're going to have actually probably three kinds of wings on the C-17 as you finish. You're going to have the static test vehicle wing that broke, and you're going to have to splice it across spars and ribs and do some changes there. You're going to have this fix, if I can use that term, of an interim kind of repair or a patchwork kind of fix that you will make to the whatever that number is, and whatever number of spars and other pieces they have ready that they'll have to fix that way to do. That's estimated to be from 20, we've heard numbers from 20 to 30 sets of aircraft wings. And then you'll have an engineering design change that'll go into the remaining aircraft wings, which would have to, beef up, would probably be a beef up of the total thing, but wouldn't be a patchwork kind of approach to the problem. Now, we've heard estimates that this business, first to fix the first 11 sets of wings with the patchwork approach would be about $52 million. Then no one knows for sure what government costs, we're going to bear with the rest of that. And of course, there's some unanswered questions with respect to what this will do in terms of long-term durability also. So that pretty much completes. We are looking at this problem with the Air Force. We think they have it well in hand in terms of reviewing it, but there are some significant unknowns that still have to be, they found out what the problems were, we believe that, but now they've got the unknowns are, what is the correct fix? So now if I'll go ahead now and proceed to the business about the financial situation at McDonnell Douglas at that time, if I can get back to that. Okay, I should also add that these financial problems involve improper appropriation fund accounting as well as the flow of money to the corporation during the later half of 1990. Our February 1992 report entitled Audit of Contractor Accounting Practice Changes for the C-17 Engineering Costs stated that reallocation of engineering costs from development to production to overcome shortfalls in development funding appeared to be part of an overall plan in 1990 to provide additional financing to McDonnell Douglas. In addition, our audit report on contracting practices for the C-17 flight test aircraft, dated April 10, 1992, stated that establishment, pricing, and Air Force acceptance of the completed assembly of the C-17 flight test aircraft, this was referred to as T-1, appeared to be part of that same bailout or financial plan. You requested in February of 1992 that we further review the concerted and planned efforts by the DOD to increase the cash flow to McDonnell Douglas during the late 1990. We conducted an extensive inquiry into the government actions concerning McDonnell Douglas's corporation's financial condition during 1990. We described how Air Force officials implemented a series of actions to provide financial assistance to McDonnell Douglas during August through December 1990 to ensure the contractor kept working on the C-17 program. Now, that is described in this obviously 100-page or so thereabouts single-spaced document in great detail, and there are, believe me, there are drawers full of documents behind this document. So, and most of our conclusions we reached, we can reach the conclusions based on the paperwork alone. We did a lot of interviewing of witnesses and so forth to establish that. But but the findings with respect to this matter are not, they're not dependent upon one particular individual or the kind of statements we receive from one individual. There is, you know, the paperwork itself will almost support the findings, and the comments from individuals, the testimony from individuals only help to amplify the situation we report we have in this report. Now, the action centered, let me get back now to the actions by the Air Force. These actions centered on meeting contractor cash flow requirements without requiring the McDonnell Douglas Corporation to disclose the nature or extent of its financial difficulties, as required by acquisition regulation for advanced or unusual payments. Expedited government payments were made that exceeded what was justified based on work performed by $349 million. Also, financing provided to the contractor exceeded the fair value of undelivered work by an additional $92 million, and that money should have been recouped. It was not timely recouped. Improper contracting actions reduced contractor financial risk on the C-17 program by $1.6 billion and created a false appearance of success to facilitate the contractor obtaining additional financing. Yes.
We have a recorded vote. We'll take care of it, and we'll come right back.
All right.
Thank you very much.
I will sit here peacefully waiting for you to come back.
Subcommittee will come to order. Mr. Vandershaft.
All right, Mr. Chairman. When we left off, I was describing how certain actions were taken to give the false appearance of success during the fall of 1990. This was at the same time that the Congress was debating the fiscal year 1991 program or acquisition for the C-17 aircraft, and the issue before the Congress at that point, the way I remember it, was a difference between about $300 million, as one committee had come forth with, and a billion another committee had come forth with. So obviously, if you look like you're showing success at this point in time, there's more of a tendency of the Congress to be willing to go along with the program, and I think that's a key issue also, that factor that's got to be taken into consideration here. Additionally, through Air Force approvals of improper cost allocations, procurement funds were used to continue paying C-17 development costs after RDT&E funds were exhausted. The responsible Air Force officials considered their actions necessary for continuing work on the program because of the cash flow difficulties being experienced by the contractor and contractor threats to stop work. However, those cash flow difficulties were largely the result of problems with commercial rather than government contracts. Those actions substantially increased government program risk, provided premature payments to the contractor, negatively impacted first aircraft delivery, and contractually obligated the government to award a subsequent Lot 3 production contract. Award of the Lot 3 production contract was particularly important because it provided an additional source of funding to the contractor and a further false indication of program success. The actions also resulted in what we believe are violations of statute and acquisition regulations. Statutory and regulatory provisions exist for providing financial assistance to contractors under certain conditions, including financial hardship. Those provisions were not applied, although their use was warranted by the circumstances. Rather, the Air Force officials chose to make improper concessions to the contractor, contrary to the intent and direction of the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition. Contract modifications were executed that were disadvantageous to the government. The C-17 system program director falsely described the contractor as meeting the production schedule in order to permit modification of the C-17 contract. Subsequently, incomplete work was accepted. The systems program director falsely described the condition of the T-1 aircraft at the time the so-called T-1 assembly complete contract line item was accepted, as the remaining work was minimal. The aircraft did not fly for another 9 months. Established government oversight and internal management control processes, including the cognizant staff functions of the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition, the Defense Contract Management Command, and the Defense Contract Audit Agency, which would have otherwise detected or prevented the questionable actions, were impaired by Air Force officials. Those officials provided incomplete and misleading information and in some cases relied on intimidation and abuse of their positions of responsibility to cause improper actions to be taken. The C-17 system program director and the Air Force program executive officer failed to acknowledge timely, report accurately, or respond properly to the deteriorating contract cost and schedule performance on the C-17. This resulted in the RDT&E funding shortfall that occurred in the fourth quarter of 1990. The negative cost performance and the projected funding shortfall were apparent from contractor reports as early as January 1990. However, proper corrective action was not initiated by the program executive officer and the systems program director. Now, the systems program director, the deputy controller of the Air Force Systems Command, the deputy chief of staff for contracting of Air Force Systems Command, improperly interfered with the process for administration of government progress payments, provided unsubstantiated and misleading information to senior acquisition officials and cognizant contract administrative personnel at the Defense Plant Representative Office in Long Beach, California, to cause premature contract payments. The C-17 system program director had primary responsibility, authority, and accountability for management of the C-17 program and was, in our opinion, keenly aware of the nature and interrelationship of relationships of all of the questionable actions taken to assist the contractor. The system program director, with support from the C-17 deputy director for contracting, misused the authority he had for procurement functions in at least three ways. One, the system program director and the C-17 deputy director for contracting provided an improper technical assessment to the Defense Contract Audit Agency on the propriety of an accounting practice change that was intended primarily to charge development costs to procurement appropriations, establishing a transition point for sustaining engineering costs that was known to be improper and based on deficient work resulted in a cost allocation methodology that charged costs to the wrong appropriation. Two, the systems program director and the C-17 deputy director for contracting improperly modified the C-17 contract based on a schedule known to be unachievable, with inadequate consideration received from the contractor for schedule slippage and establishment of an arbitrary contract line item to reduce contractor financial risk. The contractor line item was priced to the advantage of the contractor. Subsequent acceptance of the contract line item was premature and completed without resolution of potential quality deficiencies. Three, the system program director and the C-17 deputy director of contracting improperly delayed the adjustment of the progress payment rate recommended by the Cognizant Defense Contract Audit Agency and the Defense Plant Representative Office. We believe the C-17 deputy director of contracting failed to fulfill his responsibilities to ensure contractors receive impartial, equitable treatment, not preferential treatment, in accordance with law and regulation. The Assistant Secretary of the Air Force Acquisition failed to demand that the contractor formally request financial assistance from the government, including full... Yes?
I hate to interrupt you, Mr.
Chairman. I hate to interrupt you. For what purpose does the gentleman seek recognition?
It would be appropriate, Mr. Chairman, for Mr. Vandersheft to give us the names of the individuals who hold those titles as opposed to just titles. That might be helpful
sure,
for the record.
I can do that. One of the individuals has some. We're not sure about privacy considerations on one due to the individual's rank. But I can give you the names. The system program director is General Michael Butchko. The deputy controller of the Air Force Systems Command was General John Nassif. The chief of staff for contracting Air Force Systems Command is Darlene Druyan, and the other name I mentioned,
Secretary of the Air Force.
The Assistant Secretary of the Air Force for Acquisition is Mr. Jack Welch. Now, there's another, a fifth name involved here, and we have deleted that from our public statements here, although it's a close call whether or not it has to be deleted or not. And under the circumstances, I'd just soon not give you that. This is the assistant for contracting. But I'm talking basically about three general officers and one assistant secretary of the Air Force, plus an individual contracting official within the system program office.
Does that satisfy the gentleman from Oklahoma?
Sir, if I may, the additional Air Force General is Major General Barry, who's the program executive officer for the C-17 program.
At that time. Remember, all of the officials here that we're talking about are no longer in these positions. Yes. Let's get on. Now, the next part of the statement deals with the role of the Assistant Secretary of the Air Force for acquisition. We believe he failed to demand that the contractor formally request financial assistance from the government, including full disclosure of relevant financial information if assistance was considered necessary. Improper actions were taken with the knowledge of the Assistant Secretary, who is ultimately responsible for Air Force acquisition matters, and the only person who could reasonably have exercised control over so many different Air Force acquisition officials. The Assistant Secretary was kept informed of developments on the C-17 contract and progress payment matters by Air Force officials and the contractor. In our opinion, the Assistant Secretary should have demanded that his staff comply fully with established regulations and contract laws and followed up to ensure actions taken did in fact comply with legal and contractual requirements. Additionally, the Assistant Secretary failed to inform completely and accurately the Undersecretary of Defense for acquisition of the actions planned and being taken to assist McDonnell Douglas Corporation. Instead, he permitted less than complete briefings to be made that did not solicit guidance and left no basis for informed decision making. Subsequently, the briefings were used to imply to others charged with oversight and administration of the C-17 program that the Undersecretary and his staff approved Air Force positions and actions. The position of the Undersecretary of Defense for acquisition and his staff was that compliance with, now I switch to carefully note here to the Undersecretary of Defense for what, that he demanded compliance with acquisition regulations and that the contractor must request financial assistance in accordance with these regulatory requirements. The Assistant Secretary of the Air Force acquisition now failed to implement the direction of the Undersecretary and instead sought means of providing financial assistance without insisting on an above-board process involving candid disclosures of C-17 program problems and McDonnell Douglas Corporation's financial difficulties. The Defense Plant Representative Office also repeatedly requested contractor disclosure of its financial condition during August and September of 1990 for consideration in progress payment administration. The Defense Plant Representative Office efforts were thwarted by Air Force officials who implied that their actions had been approved by the Undersecretary of Defense for acquisition. The actions taken by senior Air Force officials resulted in improper financial assistance to the contractor and covered up the need to establish an executable program schedule. Additionally, the contractor acted partly with support and approval of Air Force officials to suppress negative financial information concerning losses on the program. The contractor's financial reports failed to disclose adequate losses and contingencies because reasonable efforts to estimate losses were not made. I should add here at this point, I did refer this matter to the chairman of the Securities and Exchange Commission. I guess I didn't tell the committee that, and I think you've done the same thing, and they have obviously had access to all of our records and are looking at the matter at this moment. Our findings reflect the failure of management controls in the DOD acquisition system. And now I want to get off the C-17 and get to some of the kind of what's the problem here. Management controls that would have otherwise been effective were circumvented through abuse of authority, resulting in inequitable treatment to the advantage of the contractor. Air Force officials, and in particular the C-17 Systems Program Director, acted to create an appearance of propriety for their actions and plausible deniability for any accountability on their part. For example, the System Program Director attempted to limit or lower the estimated completion used by the Administrative Contracting Officer. The Administrative Contracting Officer in this case is maybe I shouldn't get into the names that. In order to increase progress payments. Since determination of the estimated completion to be used is made by the Administrative Contracting Officer, the System Program Director viewed the Administrative Contracting Officer as solely accountable regardless of how much pressure he and other Air Force officials used to encourage premature payments and overpayments. Similarly, the systems program director considered the Defense Contract Audit Agency responsible for, quote, approving, unquote, the improper accounting practice change, which shifted engineering costs to production lots despite a faulty technical assessment provided to the DCAA by the C-17 program office. Present DOD acquisition system is a compromise between civilian control of acquisition decisions and military control of military career progression, including officer promotion, assignment, and awards. The extraordinary actions taken in the C-17 program highlight the inherent weakness in this compromise arrangement. The system program director viewed assisting the contractor financially as critical to continuation of the program and acted to do so at a time when he was being considered for promotion to Major General. The performance evaluation of the systems program director emphasized how well the C-17 program was being managed and how cost and schedule had been, quote, stabilized, unquote. The C-17 program clearly was in jeopardy under the weight of its own overruns, schedule delays, and technical problems. The system program director, with the assistance of the Deputy Controller, Air Force Systems Command, used his rank and position to direct or influence a wide range of improper actions. He was subsequently praised for his performance and promoted by the Air Force. Conversely, the Defense Plant Representative Office Commander, an Air Force colonel, acted to protect the government interest and was criticized for not being, quote, a team player. Eventually, he paid a price in future assignments determined by the Air Force that resulted in his retirement decision. This is both ironic and somewhat distressing. This individual, Colonel Tollefson, has testified on this program with the House Armed Services Committee on several occasions, I do believe. Now, we found numerous similarities between the management of the Navy A-12 program and the Air Force C-17 program during the fall of 1990. The Navy, however, conducted an administrative inquiry into the management of the A-12 program, while the Air Force, and in particular the Air Force General Counsel and Assistant Secretary for Acquisition, refused to do so. Additionally, the Navy, with the endorsement of the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition, acted to affix accountability for the errors in judgment and improper actions taken by senior acquisition officials. Nevertheless, both the Navy and the Air Force decided to promote the program managers, indicating that the military department's criteria for promotion of military acquisitions are flawed. Finally, we simply cannot afford yet another A-12 or a C-17 debacle. I believe that a fundamental change in management structure is necessary so that acquisition officials are more accountable to the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition rather than to their individual military department. Additionally, to curtail the potential for undue influence on contract administration matters, the independence of the Defense Plant Representative Office from the military departments must be strengthened to assure objectivity and decision making by the Defense Plant Representative Office. Now, a lot has been done in this particular area. I don't think my statement properly emphasizes that. The Defense Plant Representative Offices came under a new command called the Defense Contract Management Command. That happened in July of 1990. These actions were taking place concurrent with that, and there was still some, you know, that new command was kind of feeling getting its legs, if you will, and it was probably somewhat easier to intimidate them at that time than it would be today. Although, you know, again, I can't state that absolutely, but I do believe there's some of that possibility exists. Organizational independence and objectivity are absolutely essential to effective internal management control, achieved through separation of program management, procurement, and contract administration responsibilities. Now, we made some recommendations in this lengthy report here, and our recommendations focus on enhancing the independence of the procurement activities and establishing management accountability to the Milestone Decision Authority for major defense acquisition programs. We recommended disciplinary action against individuals as warranted by their actions. We made the following three specific recommendations. One, the Deputy Secretary of Defense provide full authority for selection, promotion, evaluation, and removal of program executive officers, program directors, and program managers to the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition for all major defense acquisition programs. Two, we said that the Secretary of the Air Force should take appropriate disciplinary action against the individuals involved, and that they also ought to direct an Anti-Deficiency Act violation investigation on the C-17 progress payment request, beginning with request number 97. 3, the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition direct that contract management functions for major defense acquisitions programs are made organizationally independent of the authority and supervision of program management officials. Now, in response to our report on February 19th, the Secretary of Defense requested that the Secretary of the Air Force provide any additional factual information along with a proposed response to our recommendation that disciplinary action be taken against 5 Air Force officials within 60 days. The Secretary of Defense also provided these individuals the opportunity to respond to the findings in the report. Subsequently, on February 23, 1993, the Acting Secretary of the Air Force appointed his Acting General Counsel to perform an administrative inquiry to be completed by April 13 of this year. We are cooperating fully with the Air Force Administrative Inquiry Team, commensurate with our responsibility to protect individuals who assisted us in our review from possible reprisal. We are awaiting results of the Air Force Administrative Inquiry before taking further action, if any. The Secretary of Defense has also requested the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition to provide proposed responses to our other recommendations within 60 days. We consider the actions of the Secretary of Defense to be both responsive and timely. At some point, maybe in today's hearing, I want to discuss the period of time between the time that the Secretary of Defense took some action on February the 19th and the period of time when we issued the report on January the 14th, because we had some difficulties during that period, and maybe we'll talk
about it now.
Well, the situation was we issued this report at first, and some of the information in this report had contractor proprietary information in it. We wanted to be sure that we gave the McDonnell Douglas Corporation due process, that they had an opportunity to tell us what was proprietary in their eyes, that would influence their competitive position or otherwise be harmful to them, and that would be coverable under the proprietary information statute. But I had a responsibility to provide this report, you know, to the Secretary of the Air Force, to this committee that had requested it, and a copy to the House Armed Services Committee. I took steps by calling appropriate people to include the Assistant Secretary of the Air Force for Financial Management, who was a recipient of the report as a normal routine, the way audit reports flow, about this situation. And please do not do anything publicly with respect to this matter until we give the corporation a chance to respond. And I asked the same of the staffs of the committees here to make sure that they handled the report accordingly. And things seemed to be going fine. It was a couple of days later that the Secretary of the Air Force announced that, quote, he was going to hire an independent consultant, I guess, to review our actions. I said, well, what's this? I first thought this was just, well, this is just a kind of a gut reaction. We don't like this report, so we're going to do this. I thought we had done an independent review, and I mean, no one had even come to ask to look at the detailed backup papers of what we had. They decided they needed, quote, another independent review. We found out, you know, that this was involved in this independent review, and that began to, and I have come to really get excited, because immediately alarm bells rang off. Wait a minute, it looks like what they're doing is they're already hiring legal assistance for these people and contracting for it. Our copy of our report with the official use only status was sent to a law firm in Washington. We still hadn't cleared this thing for proprietary data. A contract was offered to a law firm in Washington without competition, and so forth. So I wrote, I'll make this letter a copy, put it in the record if you want, that I had to write the Secretary of the Acting Secretary of the Air Force and say, hey, knock this off. This is ridiculous. You're engaging people who are going to review actions about disciplinary matters involving Air Force people. Now, I think that the government is perfectly capable of undertaking such actions on its own and so forth. It wasn't until Secretary Aspin got, you know, on board and got this thing straightened out on February the 19th that I think we sort of got off of this kick, and things seem to be straightened away now anyway, at least. But I'll make that letter a matter of record with respect to that. And I would just, I also want to tell you that I was just unwilling to provide our working papers to some law firm that we don't know if they've got conflicts of interest, what other defense contractors they represent, whether they, you know, there's all kinds of questions raised when you do this with just, you know, in a knee-jerk kind of reaction that took place in response to this report. So I think that can stop on that business. Now, the next part that we want to deal with is our, I guess it's maybe our fourth report on the C-17, but it's one we issued back in May of last year, and it was done at the request of the Senate Armed Services Committee. And what we looked there is we went into this issue of what are the alternatives, and has the department properly reviewed the alternatives to the C-17? We kind of concluded that none of the previous analysis had determined the most cost-effective mix of aircraft for a total airlift fleet, which potentially could be composed of C-17, C-141s that had undergone a service life extension program, C-5s, C-130s, and so forth. Now, our recommendations, which were incorporated into the National Defense Authorization Act of 93, included conducting a Defense Acquisition Board program review prior to the award of Lot 5 production contract and performing a formal cost and operational effectiveness analysis of this airlift aircraft business. I should add now that in view of what's happened, I said we had made that recommendation last May to get this review done before they award Lot 5. Well, Lot 4 has not been awarded yet, and my understanding is now that Lot 4 is sort of, you know, in a holding pattern here, and I would recommend now that they not award Lot 4 either until they go ahead and do this cost and operational effectiveness analysis that we had recommend there. And that process also seems to be on track. That my understanding is the Institute for Defense Analysis is looking at these problems and making some comparisons and so forth. And during, again, the questions, we'll be prepared to maybe discuss some of that as we go along. The last part, I don't think I'm even going to. It's in my statement. Begins on page 21 and 22. It deals with the sustaining engineering costs and accounting changes, which eventually resulted in about $172 million in being moved. If you move from RDT&E to procurement retroactively, and it's a continuing problem. There are two letters attached onto my statement. One was a letter to the acting Secretary of the Air Force dated February 5, and the acting Secretary's reply of March 1 concerning this Anti-Deficiency Act matter. But in the interest of time, let me just kind of pass on that, and obviously we're prepared to discuss it in more detail should the committee desire. I think I've probably gone on long enough, sir, and I'll defer at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vandersheff. The committee is honored to have Senator Charles Grassley of Iowa, a distinguished member of the Armed Services Committee, here at the podium with us. And Senator Grassley, would you like to, do you have a statement to make, or do you have questions, or both?
Well, I have both, but I'm well aware of the comity between the House and Senate, and I presumed that I was going to be the last on the schedule and was prepared to be the last on the schedule. If you want me to go ahead with my questions and with a statement, I would be glad to do that, though, and would be honored to do that.
Well, does your time permit, Senator, for us to question Mr. Vandersheff, or would you want to go in front of him?
I can be here until 12 o'clock.
Well, I'd like to do this to accommodate Senator Grassley. I would like us to hold all questions to Mr. Vandersheff and allow the Senator to go forward. We appreciate him coming over, and we're happy to hear him at this time. I would like you to take your position at the witness stand, Senator, if you will.
You want me to go down in front?
Yes, down in front.
Okay.
No, get out of here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I also remember the fine time that you and I had between 1974 and 1980 serving together in the House, and working on very many important things, and I thank you very much for your courtesy in letting me participate. And I also want to thank the ranking Republican, Mr. Candless, for allowing me to participate in this hearing as well. Your hearing is so important because it's about what I consider the total breakdown of discipline and integrity in the DOD procurement process. It's about fixing responsibility for wrongdoing and accountability. I'm here for two reasons. First, I want to offer moral support in this effort. And secondly, I will, if it isn't appropriate at this time, I'll leave some questions that I was going to ask Mr. Vandershaft. If there's opportunity for me to do that, I'd like to do that as well. But I'll leave that at your discretion. But I'll at least give Mr. Vandershaft an opportunity to know at the end of my statement the questions that I have, and presumably, considering the in-depth of your investigation and your concern, Chairman Conyers, I would say you'd probably have some of the same questions as well. Now, of course, I think I should make it very clear that I don't think myself or anybody on this committee comes here to sabotage the C-17 program, because I think there is a general agreement that we need to modernize our fleet of transport aircraft. But if we stay on the present course, I don't think there's going to be any C-17. I think the C-17 will self-destruct under dishonest management. You, Mr. Chairman, and your able assistant, Eric Thorson, with the help of the Department of Defense Inspector General, Mr. Vandershaft, together, I think, have done a very superb piece of work in examining the financial mismanagement of the C-17 program. And I think you should be complimented by my saying, and I hope what's a general agreement, that that this is a oversight and investigation at its very best. I think it's also representative of the process of government working. I don't think you're here or I'm here in any way to take on a particular industry or to take on a particular program, but there's certain processes of government that Mr. Vandershaft's been involved in, and we want to make sure that what recommendations for improvement that have been made are carried out in every respect. And that, again, is an oversight responsibility, more so than a point of substance about a particular industry or a particular weapon system. You, of course, have provided leadership and direction, and the Department of Defense Inspector General has done a thorough investigation, and I think, as it's been presented here, you can see that it's a real team effort. The current phase of the C-17 review culminated in January 93 with the publication of the report that's been referred to this morning. I think it's a devastating report. It suggests a total disregard for the laws that govern the use of the taxpayers' money. What we have uncovered here, I believe, Mr. Chairman, is an emerging $1.5 billion cost overrun on a fixed price contract. The contractor is threatened with major financial losses. To soften the blow, senior Air Force officials appear to have devised various schemes to cover up mounting schedule delays and burgeoning cost overruns in order to maintain an uninterrupted flow of money to the company. This was a backdoor bailout operation, I believe. When all R&D money was exhausted and there was still $235 million outstanding of R&D bills to pay, these officials arbitrarily shifted the cost overrun to the production contract where there was plenty of extra cash. This may have violated several statutes, including the Anti-Deficiency Act, and I think the Inspector General has referred to that. And I think they continue to make progress payments that were not commensurate with the work performed, and I think that this is a potential violation of 10 U.S.C. 2307. The alleged illegal progress payments totaled $350 million, according to the IG. The facts in the case have been carefully and thoroughly documented and verified in the DOD's IG report. The investigation is complete. The DOD IG has recommended that appropriate disciplinary action be taken against five senior Air Force officials who are named in his report. One of the military officers recommended for disciplinary action is Brigadier General John M. Nosif. As difficult as it is to comprehend, Mr. Chairman, this general's nomination for promotion to the rank of Major General was submitted to the Senate for approval on January the 20th of 93. And this was after the IG's report was issued. Probably rhetorical, but because I'm not sure the people here can answer it. But how can we be talking about General Nosif's promotion when disciplinary action is called for? To me, this defies all reason and understanding. So in a letter, Mr. Chairman, to the chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee on February the 16th, I formally requested that this general's promotion be denied based upon the contents of the Department of Defense Inspector General report. The nature and scope of the wrongdoing by senior Air Force officials has been partially defined. Responsibility has been fixed. It's a time to hold those persons accountable for what happened. This is, in my judgment, no time to back off. It's no time for weak knees. Above all, I advocate accountability to the full extent that is justified by the facts presented in the IG's report. And it is on this point, accountability, where I have concerns. I would say to Mr. Vandershaft that I have concluded that the findings and recommendations presented in his report may not be fully consistent with the facts presented in the report. The facts presented in the report suggest that misconduct may be far more serious than has been indicated. These facts suggest that federal criminal laws may have been violated, and if so, those must be, according to the law, expeditiously reported to the Attorney General as required by the Inspector General's Act of 1978. I raise this issue with the Inspector General in a letter dated February the 16th of this year. His reply is to me came back on March the first, and the reply is quite frankly very disappointing, Mr. Chairman, and also to Mr. Vandershaft, who's here. I feel like the Inspector General might be trying to dodge the issue. I feel like he is trying to take cover behind the Air Force reinvestigation of the IG's investigation. The reinvestigation is ongoing and is to be completed by April the 13th. I fear that the reinvestigation is really nothing more than a Pentagon damage limitation operation to discredit Mr. Vandershaft's otherwise very good report and to save the careers of some people in the military. My questions that I would ask to Mr. Vandershaft pertain only to the facts presented in the printed report. My questions have nothing to do with a reinvestigation. They're really questions that are restated from my February 16th letter. And I think if there are answers to my questions that were in that letter based just on the information in the report, the letter that I received in response would have been more firm, more responsive, and more definite. I hope that that the Inspector General still stands 100% behind all the facts that are in the report. In a sense, I ask that of the very respected Inspector General. There's an aspect of some false statements in regard to the report clearly indicating that General Buchko, the program director, and possibly others knowingly made false and misleading statements to cover up the cost overruns and schedule delays in order to keep the money flowing to the contractor. Did General Buchko or any of the others violate
18 U.S.C. 1001 or Article 107 of the Uniform Code of Military Justice? If so, has the Inspector General reported this matter to the Attorney General as required by the Inspector General's Act of 1978? It seems to me that we and our constitutional oversight responsibilities have a right to know that when the facts are pretty plain, that when law has been violated, that the Inspector's Act should be followed. I think it's our way of demanding accountability. We can't have weakness in this area. If you send if you signal weakness in this area, you're going to just encourage further disregard of the law in the future. And there's none of us are going to dispute Mr. Vandershaft's qualifications and the good job that he does. I consider him a friend. I consider him a very good public servant. And I think maybe to some extent, considering his report and the reinvestigation, that to some extent he might be caught in the middle between people in the defense industry and people in DOD on the one hand. And I'm not going to let him get caught in the middle. I hope he doesn't want to get caught in the middle. The retroactive accounting practice changes, also known as the journal voucher transfer, described in the report, matches perfectly with a scenario described on page 10 of the cost mischarging sections of indicators of fraud in DOD procurement. And that's a document that was published by Mr. Vandershaft's office in 1987. The scenario describes precisely what happened on the C-17 contracts. So has fraud been committed on any of the C-17 contracts? If so, this demands that proper action be taken. The report states that General Buchko, Nassif, and others, quote, acted in concert, unquote, to develop and implement a plan which was based on false and misleading information. The words false and misleading are from the report, and deception, also from the report, to make illegal payments to the contractor. Did these officials engage in a conspiracy and violate 18 U.S.C. 371 and Article 81 of the Code of Military Justice? If so, then the law is pretty clear what the Inspector General must do. Is the contractor's performance deficient in any respect against C-17 contractual requirements? If the contractor is in default, what steps have been taken to protect the government's interest? I think bottom line, as you look at people expressing their will in the last election and the responsibility of public officials to respond to that, both those of us as elected as well as those who aren't, I think that we saw a message for change, a message to make government work, in the words of the President, kind of the reinventing of government. And I think I see too much in the C-17 as business as usual. And I think that's what this hearing hopefully is all about, to make sure that business as usual is no longer the name of the game in town, that we're really making a big difference. I thank you very much.
We're indebted to you, Senator Grassley, for your very timely intervention. We welcome it. The questions will be included in the record, and we'll ask Mr. Vandershaft to respond to them in writing, and if he chooses to respond to any portion of them at this point, he may.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think it's essential I respond to those right now. I'm fully prepared to respond to those questions. This question of criminality came up, but it came up late in this process. So, you know, we began this inquiry strictly as an administrative matter to review and determine whether, you know, McDonnell Douglas was receiving greater progress payments than those they should have, and if so, why were these payments being made? What we discovered was that several individuals engaged in highly improper activities to ensure greater cash flow to McDonnell Douglas than was permitted. They completely disregarded the procurement regulations and so forth. You know, I find their behavior, Senator Grassley, inappropriate. I find it offensive. I believe they exhibited incredibly bad judgment in their zeal to protect the C-17 program. And that was a goal which was shared not only by them, but it was shared by the Air Force as an institution at this point in time. So, when we put this whole thing together in December, I was working on this with the staff that's here at the table primarily. You know, we had some decisions to make with respect to what we did with this thing at this point in time. I wasn't sure their actions, you know, rose to the level of criminality under Chapter 18 of the U.S. Code. And in addition, three of the individuals are subject to the Uniform Code of Military Justice. So you've still got the action, and that has to be, any action there has to be taken by the Air Force. I also had the difficulty of some of the other violations, and there are violations here, we're quite convinced, the Anti-Deficiency Act violations, 31 U.S.C. 1341, which exceeds an appropriation in the amount you have, or 1517, which deals with the violating the administrative subdivisions of an appropriation, or the 1301 that just deals with spending more money than you have appropriated for the purposes for which, you know, you have to do that with. We had a situation here where the Air Force was in effect part of the problem as I saw it at this point. Now, maybe with this new process ongoing, Senator Grassley, and this new review, maybe the Air Force will look at its good and its welfare and its needs and will sever itself from those of the individuals whose actions we contest in this report. I don't know how that'll come out. I certainly had the very same problems you had initially at first, that this was, you know, they wanted to quote an independent review and they were going to hire an outside counsel, a law firm in Washington without any prior competition or any determination whether the law firm had conflicts of interest and so forth. And it looked to me like it was a setup to build a big defense case from day one for these people, rather than to look at the facts that we had uncovered in doing this investigation. So I'm sensitive to what your comments were. I guess my response to you and your letter was not as good as it could have been, but I'm under the gun here to wait this thing out, and let's see what the Air Force officials come up with as they conduct their own review, and they can basically do a lot of that, they can do almost all of it from our own files and records, which they've had full access to. So I guess that's generally my comment to the Senator's comment.
You have that discretion under the 78 Act to wait. Reporting to the Attorney General.
We haven't waived it. I think it's incumbent also to explain that without some Air Force support in this matter, it's going to be very difficult for a United States Attorney to deal with it or the Justice Department. But that's not necessarily my decision. They also have the option under the Uniform Code, and they can deal with that solely on their own. So the matter isn't closed. I believe the committee also referred this matter to the Department of Justice when we gave the report to the committee. Is that correct, Mr. Chairman?
You're absolutely right.
All right. So it's in that arena at this point.
The chair recognizes Mr. McCandless.
Well, thank you, Chair. Are you planning to exercise the 5-minute rule?
Do you want me to exercise the 5-minute rule?
Well, it would. I need to plan my approach.
Plan my work and work my plan?
Well, I do not plan to exercise the 5-minute rule.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. What I'm going to do is what I think is essential in the way of building blocks. I'm neither pro or con either side. But to understand this, with what I have been given in the way of information to assimilate, it's necessary for me to ask certain questions that will give me then a clear indication from your point of view, the position that you have as a result of your investigation. So with that, let me ask the first question. It is my understanding that the contractual agreement between the federal government and the McDonnell Douglas Corporation does not differentiate between R&D and the amount of money necessary to produce the first test model. Is that correct?
No, that's not correct. The contract differentiates, however, the total dollar value of the contract in the end does not differentiate. But the legal opinions have been rendered by the Air Force itself that there is still a requirement to segregate the RDT&E non-recurring engineering costs for this item from the acquisition or production costs that are involved. Maybe Mr. Rao wants to add something to that.
No, the contract does call for separation, as Mr. Vandeschef is stating, and that's done through various vehicles. Matter of fact, even the progress payments submitted by the contractor to the government must be separated by the type of costs incurred, in essence, by appropriation.
Then it's your position that to commingle these funds would be in violation of the intent of the contract as it's currently written.
Yes, to spend those funds for purposes other than they were appropriated. There are rules with respect to how you spend research and development, test and evaluation funds, and how you spend procurement funds.
Because that's a point in your report that you make.
And they obviously understood those rules, Mr. McCandless, or they wouldn't have gone back and done a retroactive accounting change where they, by definition, decided that, well, wait a minute, we're going to use 90% drawing release as the point at which we switch from non-recurring engineering to recurring. And then, and if I can go into this just a little bit more, I mean, that is so descriptive of they knew they couldn't just simply say, well, this is all one contract, we can use any kind of money we want. I mean, they wouldn't have gone and done that. Now, I can get into some of the details of how they did that.
The basic question has been answered.
Okay, good.
It is their contention that that there is not a distinguishing difference between the two.
That is flat wrong.
There's a difference.
I don't know who gave you that, but that's flat wrong. Even the Air Force wouldn't back that up.
All right. Secondly, for purposes again of setting the necessary building block, irrespective of how all of the dollars have or have not been spent, illegally, whatever you wish to place on the table as being improper, has the Air Force paid McDonnell Douglas more than the $6.7 million that was part of the original agreement?
Not to this point, no, sir.
Okay.
That original agreement was $6.5 billion, but it's grown to about a little over $6.6 billion today.
For purposes of the record, my information is that the base contract number 2108 is a $6.7 billion fixed price contract for research and development, one static test article, one durable test article, and one test plane, parenthesis T1. That's where is my information correct?
No. You want to get into what the 6.6 includes? He's on included.
Read that one more time. I just want to make sure that they were all there.
Okay. The C-17 base contract, 2108, is a $6.7 billion fixed price contract for research and development, one static test article, one durability test article, one test plane, and the first six production planes.
I didn't read the first six production. I didn't the first
that
time.
Last
okay,
part.
That's why.
Yeah.
All right.
So where are we now in the completion of this, separate from the lack of possibly the planes to perform according to design or according to production shortcomings? Where are we in terms of producing what is necessary to comply with this contract?
Well, and I'm not sure in what sense. Obviously, even though we haven't paid.
Do we have the first six production planes?
No.
How many of those do we have?
We have four, I believe.
And when is it estimated that the next two will be completed?
I believe one is due to deliver any time soon here now. It keeps getting postponed, and that's a critical one, but I don't have the exact date. And the other one is due a couple of months after that, is my understanding. Right. Whether they'll make it or not, I don't know. I'm not up to the minute with the program management of the thing. So,
in terms of a timeline, does your original contract state that certain parts of this contractual delivery line have a fixed date to them?
Oh, most certainly. This contract, first flight was supposed to occur back August 9th of 1990. First flight didn't occur until September 15, 1991. Those things were, you know, the failure to perform that first flight in a timely manner, that was waived off.
What time in the contract was the contract 2108 to be completed with the production planes?
The last one, you have that handy, the last production delivery of the sixth aircraft on 2108. You got another exact, originally, as not as, not, see, this was renegotiated as part of the problem that I've been discussing this morning.
I'm talking about 2108, no renegotiation.
Yes, 2108 was renegotiated.
I want the original contract.
Original day, okay. We'll get it for you. I think we have it here.
Look it up
and you can go ahead to the next question. But it was sometime approximately, if I recall, about a year later than the original first flight, which was August of 90. But
I don't want to take all of the time here.
Okay, that's all right.
But this is a technical thing, because I have a certain mechanical background, and I found this thing very interesting relative to rivets.
All right.
And the fact that I travel quite extensively back and forth from the east to the west coast on DC-10s, MD-80s, and I'm wondering now, if the rivets are going to pop in some of these airplanes that are made by McDonnell Douglas because of what you consider to be the shortcoming of the rivets in this particular plane, why would there be a differential in the technology between those types of produced airplanes and what we're talking about here, to the degree that the issue has been made out of it?
I haven't made any issue with respect to their commercial aircraft. There's different metals.
No. I'm okay. Talking about the basic riveting procedure. Why is it different?
I'm not sure the procedure was different. The quality control wasn't there.
Right. It was quality control then.
Yes. Basically, you got talking about a quality control problem.
Now, again, this is a little technical, so bear with me. You talk in your statement about a tolerance of, if I'm reading the decimals correctly, 100 to 200 of an inch.
I'm talking, let's put it in thousandths of an inch. I'm talking the difference when they get above expansions above 10,000ths of an inch. The data and with respect to the two metals that were being
You've got 0.01, 0.02 mm-hmm. in your testimony. Isn't that hundredths of an inch?
No, thousandths of an inch.
10 thousandths is a hundredth of an inch.
Somewhere along the line, my math has gotten screwed up. It's on page 2 of your testimony, I think, isn't it?
Well, let's get into the report itself. Find page 2, would you?
Under recommendations on page 3, I'm sorry. And there's been parentheses on the third line of the paragraph headed recommendations.
Okay. That's right.
That's 100.
What is that meant to mean?
100th of an inch to two 100ths of an inch.
So If we drilled a hole and we took the rivet in question and we dropped it into the hole prior to doing anything with it, there would be from 100 to 200ths of an inch variation between the inside wall of the hole and the diameter or circumference of the diameter,
no.
I should say, of
no,
the rivet.
No. There should be almost a perfect fit. There might be a very little. This is how much I'm talking about here, how much the rivet has been expanded to press into the two metals together.
We haven't done anything to it yet.
Well, I'm not referring to that distance at all here.
All right, you're talking about the rivet expansion then, once it's been pressed?
Yes.
Okay. Expansion right. Beyond the diameter of the hole that was drilled.
I guess where I'm coming from is so many thousands of planes have been built using all kinds of rivets, using all kinds of metals. The fasteners have been pressed rivets.
Mm-hmm.
And when we talk in terms of commercial, whether it's Boeing, or if we talk about Lockheed, or we talk about McDonnell Douglas, it is not some new engineering feat to put a rivet in a hole and expand it. Yet, this seems to be a big thing here relative to the production quality of this plane. And I need a little explanation as to why such a simple action has become such a big deal.
Let me start, and then Mr. Stavenyard can carry this on even further if you want to. Obviously, they used a somewhat new methodology, and it was related to both. They used a drive-matic tool that was supposed to speed up the process and so forth. This committee held hearings in the fall of November of 1991, I believe, based upon two witnesses from the corporation that had come forward to describe poor quality controls and other problems regarding the manufacture of those wings, to include a lot of difficulties with rivets. At that time, we, along with the Federal Bureau of Investigation, were conducting a criminal investigation with respect to these matters, and we had done some consensual monitoring and so forth within that confines of that criminal investigation, and had found statements that were, you know, very questionable statements about the quality of these wings and what was going on. And we finished that up. The committee held these hearings, and the allegation was that these rivets were not being expanded enough to get the full integrity, get the maximum strength that you can make. They had to be expanded at least 1/1000th of an inch, is my understanding. And they were not, according to these people, they were not always getting that. But for some reason, the coupons, the actual, and you can get a coupon out here and show them what a coupon looks like, a test run that they make before they start and when they end. They do these coupons, these metal coupons, and they plug rivets in it to make sure they're getting the right tensions and the right expansions. A test script, yes, sir. Same thing. And they then cut those open, and the engineers look at it, and they document it on a coupon data sheet what they saw and what happened, and so they know what they're dealing with. All of this material suddenly during this criminal investigation process disappeared, sir. It wasn't it was gone. So we finished up with the criminal matter, and I'm not sure the committee, its investigative staff here, is finished up with entirely, but we finished up with that. And I sent the technical team from the audit organization and our engineering people to look at what was going on, and they found some of the coupon data sheets. They didn't find, you know, the original metal coupons themselves, but they found the coupon data sheets. They began to look at those, and they looked particularly for number 12 slugs, 3/8 inch slugs of a certain type, and they looked at what was going on, and they said, my golly, we're getting expansions here at least twice the maximum ever allowed by other processing standards. And I get into proprietary data. I want to be a little bit careful about this. These companies consider some of this proprietary. Those expansions were twice as much, Mr. McCandless. And we said, well, wait a minute, isn't this a bit of a problem here? Show us that you have tested metals of this type expanded to those distances, amounts. And you know, we still have not been able to find that, and we're concerned that this will lead to stress fractures, cracking and corrosion problems down the road, long after, you know, the warranties on the airplanes are gone, because the warranty is based upon the durability test aircraft, and we got the coupon data sheets for it, the same overexpansions had not occurred. Remember, they were having problems. They got pressure that they weren't getting enough expansion. We have reason to believe, and this is only theoretical, probably what happened is people said, gee, we're not getting enough expansion. Let's turn it up. Let's crank it up and make sure we get enough. And in the process, they probably have got a good number of rivets in some of those early wings overexpanded.
Are they using this kind of a riveting process on their commercial?
Yes, they are, sir. On the MD-80, is that correct, Ken? Are they?
The Douglas process specifications or standards that were used or modified for the this aircraft were in fact the same processes or started from the processes that are used on their commercial aircraft.
Let me summarize. You're saying that the problem here is a lack of quality control.
Yes, sir.
As seen by those on site responsible for a specification on the final product.
That's correct.
So it's theoretically possible then that we'd have commercial airplanes flying around that would have the same problem?
I'm not prepared to comment on that. I don't know.
Is there an overkill here?
In an overkill in the sense that, yes, I think this problem could have been resolved with very little money and very little trouble had somebody wanted to do it. I testified to that earlier this morning when I said,
You said $10,000 to $15,000, somebody in Seattle would do a number.
Right.
And my question at that time in my mind was, a basic riveting process, which is an integral part of constructing any type of an aircraft frame, wing and all of the other components, is a part of the every day, every hour, every minute procedure, and we're going to ask somebody for $15,000 to see if we're doing it right? That boggles my mind, because if we have that kind of a problem, then I'm wondering how we install the engines, and what about the landing gear, and what about the rest of it? No, we don't.
Mr. McCandless, I had sort of the same philosophy, I guess, that you've expressed here. How can this be a problem? You know, we've been doing rivets in Rosie the Riveter, World War II. I mean, we certainly don't have, but you find when you get into this business, this becomes an exotic, structural integrity kind of issue. And there's a lot of, engineering time and effort spent on this, especially as you get to new and different materials and you use different processes. So it's not as simple a problem as one would first believe.
Contractors did have massive problems with the riveting on this aircraft. The drive-matic machines made a lot of mistakes that was due apparently to lack of training of the operators and other problems, and thousands of rivets had to be pulled and replaced. But what we're talking about here is the potential effect of overexpansion. And to test what that overexpansion effect might be, you have to test the exact materials being used in the aircraft you're talking about, because that potential effect will be different depending on the hardness of the aluminum that you're talking about and what the stack up is. There are several different materials and layers here, and a rivet goes through all of them. So we think you need to duplicate what is actually on the C-17. Put some rivets through it, the same kinds of rivets are on the C-17, and then study the corrosive effects, the fatigue effects over time. It's a fairly simple test. It's been done before for other aircraft, but our point is that it hasn't been done for anything equivalent to the C-17 wings.
Well, Mr. Chairman, you've been very patient with me. I have other questions, but we have other members of the panel, I'm sure, who have questions.
Thank you. Gentlelady from New York, Ms. Maloney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Would you turn to page 10 of your testimony? When you mentioned that there was established government oversight and internal management control processes that would have prevented this, but you stated it was not detected or prevented because the questionable actions were impaired by Air Force officials, and you stated that they relied on intimidation and abuse of their positions of responsibility to cause improper actions to take place. That's a very strong statement. Would you give us some details on the form of intimidation which was exerted by the generals on lower-ranking officers? And in your opinion, is this type of intimidation continuing?
Let me have Mr. Ryle answer. He can answer that in great detail, and I may add some addition to it. Go ahead, Russ.
When we use the terms intimidation, we're talking about outside of their direct supervision. These individuals also supervise fairly large staffs and operations, but when we talk about intimidation, we're talking about outside of their direct chain of command, where they could direct a subordinate to take a particular action.
Subordinate in terms of rank, not in the chain of command subordinate. Mm-hmm.
And what we found was that the individuals, because of their grade level and the positions that they held, were highly regarded, and they used that to influence, for example, as we discuss in the report, progress payments being made prematurely to the contractor. And they, in addition, they used it to describe the contractor's financial condition as a basis for releasing the premature payments. They described the nature of high-level meetings that they had attended to individuals not directly in their chain of command, and then informed them that they needed to make these payments for various reasons.
So in other words, they told their subordinates they had to make these payments and they had to follow the chain of command of the position and make the payments. Do you think the intimidation is taking place now? Is it continuing?
Hopefully it's not.
Hopefully not.
Our concern is, and this is one of the things we've worked out with the Air Force people that are looking at our investigation or doing their own review of the matter, with respect to the handing of certain transcripts that we have taken from witnesses in this, we're very concerned about reprisal. And I work with reprisal every day, ma'am. And it happens, and we've gotten many cases of it that we review from time to time. So that's one of our concerns. I hope it's not taking place anymore with respect to the C-17 program between the current program management and the DPRO, the Defense Plant Representative Office, the government people that are in the facility where the aircraft is being assembled, or with the contract audit agency, the people who audit this program and this contract.
Even if safeguards were in place, as you testified, should there have been some type of red flag in the Secretary's office when payments of this size, we're talking about a $435 million advanced inappropriate payment, which you testified earlier, even when they are hidden or made, shouldn't this have been flagged in some way so that it doesn't happen in the future?
I think that would be difficult to do. There's many programs going on. An individual payment or check of that amount is rather high or unusual, but it's not altogether unusual, I would say, in terms of progress on a major program, a major production program. So that wouldn't in itself set off any red flags.
Well, do you think we should have Congress require that whenever accelerated payments or payments without contracts over $100 million, that the Secretary approve it in writing and notify Congress?
That is already.
We need to get a control on the spending, okay. And if we had known that there were problems with this, maybe we could have saved a lot of taxpayers'
money. That is already required. Congress has faced this problem before, and 10 U.S.C. 2307, I believe, and I have the right citation there. If you want to check, it says, if you're going to pay unusual or advanced progress payments and the amount is more than $25 million, you have to come back to the Congress before you make such payments. And, here again, we believe those payments to those amounts were in fact made, but the proper reports were not filed with the Congress because, you see, doing that would reflect badly on the program. And if you want the program to go at all costs, you don't want bad news about the program coming forward.
Well, in your opinion, are the problems with McDonnell Douglas, from the cost overruns to the illegal payments, is this an isolated incidence, or is this an example of systemic procurement problems in the system?
Well, we try. We believe that part of this may be systemic in the sense that, and I'm a little reluctant to use this word, but since the General Accounting Office uses this word and they serve the Congress, the cultural problem in the acquisition process is what I'm referring to here, where you a program gets this huge head of steam, military department is very wedded to it. The department wants it. It's critical to them, and I can give you numerous examples over the years of this. Going, the C-5 at one time fell in this category, the B-1, the B-2, the Trident submarine, whatever the case may be, the SSS-21 submarine, so forth. It develops a head of steam, if you will, et cetera. You have military officers whose promotion and standing and rank among their compatriots and among their institution in which they work is somewhat dependent upon them bringing this critical program home, getting this thing.
Even to the extent of violating the law?
Well, that's where things get fuzzy, ma'am, when people start questioning, well, we can bend the regulations, we can
that
tilt on this.
That wasn't a regulation, that was a law, to notify Congress an overrun.
That's correct.
Of spending money that for which there is no contract. Now, does this take place routinely, or is that what you're implying?
No, that doesn't take place routinely. If it did, I'd be here all the time, I guess. No, it was quite unusual. This program was in trouble, and this happens when programs are in trouble, particularly when they're early. We saw exactly the same thing in the A-12.
But there were ways to legally address the problem.
Oh, yes, absolutely. There's also another law called 85804. And 85804 says, come back to the Congress, get your money, and let's get straightened out. But again, the decision was discussed at some of these meetings. The decision was made, we don't need 85804. We've got to find $550 million between August of 1990 and December of 1990, before the end of the financial year, for the company, and we're going to find that. And I use the term "find" in quotes here. You know, we're going to find that in other ways.
Can you give us some suggestions of how we can make sure this doesn't happen in the future with congressional oversight? They knowingly violated two laws that we passed in order to get some type of control and oversight of procurement. Do you have any suggestions of how we can enforce the laws that we have or construct a better system so that this doesn't happen in the future?
Go ahead.
Make recommendations in a separate audit report dealing with contractor cost and schedule control systems. And I believe that they're very relevant to this, in that we recommend that the estimated completion, which is the factor that determines the level of payments when a contractor is in the loss position, be calculated in a certain manner such that these types of things would not occur. And we believe that's very relevant. Now, the Department of Defense, we've asked them, has initially non-concurred with that recommendation. We've asked them to reconsider their position on it. But we believe that that if the estimate of completion is calculated based on a valid formula, and that that's considered by the administrative contracting officer in reaching his determination on progress payments, that then we will be protected from the kinds of things we saw with the C-17 program.
Are there any other recommendations? Because cost overruns are often a way of life in government contracts.
And they're going to happen. And I don't have a real problem with a cost overrun as long as it's revealed. If you don't reveal a cost overrun, it often also reflects technical problems. The two are related. And your financial indicator may come up earlier as a red flag than your technical indicator may come up, although they may come up the same. And you're going to have test failures as well. That's what we test for, so that doesn't bother us. But the process that got us here is Mr. Russ said, when they couldn't get an estimated completion that met their needs so they could make a full payment, they figured out a new way to do an estimated completion, so they didn't have to reduce the progress payment. And we're trying to tighten down on that. Obviously, it's partly in some respects our fault. We're in there auditing. We should be doing our job between, the organization I'm currently serving to try to lead, and the Defense Contract Audit Agency and the Defense Contract Management Command. We all have responsibilities to make sure these things don't happen. And we got to be sure, we're alert, and we don't get pushed around when we recognize it. Unfortunately, the contract and management people here who work for the Defense Logistics Agency has started to, at this point in time, recognize this problem. They tried to do something about it, but you know, they were intimidated, in effect, not to do much about it.
Earlier, you identified three generals who were involved with the problem. Is there any civilian oversight over the actions of these generals? If so, what kind of civilian oversight? You seem to indicate that there was this
there was this
willingness to succeed within the department, and so they made accommodations. What type of civilian oversight?
In this particular instance, we hold the Assistant Secretary of the Air Force for acquisition principally responsible to provide that kind of day-to-day oversight that is required in something as sensitive and as large as this program. There's also oversight that comes in the form from the assistant, the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition, a relatively new position in the department, about, I guess, 6 years old now. That oversight is also there, and then you've got other civilian kinds of oversight, such as the Contract Audit Agency, our organization, and so forth. So I don't think it's a problem of a lack of oversight. It's there. People sometimes decide, you know, to not follow the rules to the least of the letter.
May I ask one last question? The last C-5B, which was a cargo plane built in 1990, cost $95 million. Now I ask you, why does the C-17 cost nearly $400 million? And how did we select McDonnell Douglas to build this plane? Was it competitively bid? Was it a negotiated contract? Why is there such a great discrepancy between two planes which are basically the same, large cargo planes with a little technical differences, one stops in a smaller space than the other? That is a huge, huge difference. Can you explain why taxpayers have to pay so much more for a C-17 than a C-5?
In my opinion, they shouldn't be, ma'am. That's I can't really explain why it happened. If you go back when we were delivering the last C-5B, which we ordered, and I think we got delivery of the last one in 1988. About that time, we were looking at what was the cost of the C-1 or C-17 at that point versus the C-5, and the C-17 wasn't all that much more expensive. I think its price at that point in time, and I don't try to your $100 million. I think the figures I have are about $115 million for a C-5B. But it may be depend what whether you're the end of the production line or where you are. And we're talking like $140 million at that point for a C-17. So when you do these kinds of analysis and you say, well, we get these extra features, we get the 3,000-foot runway, but we have to add some complexity to the C-17. We got to put quadruple redundant fly-by-wire system in it. We got to use lots of computers to fly this airplane, and so forth. That increases the cost, but we said that was worth it because it was, you know, a few million dollars per airplane, and it had, you know, it used less space on the hard stands. It could turn around, it could back up, and it could do some other things. Now, what you're coming into question, and I can discuss those if you want to, but at that point, it looked like a good deal. We've issued an audit report and say, hey, this doesn't look like such a good deal anymore. We found out that, you know, instead of some 3,000 or 4,000 more runways that this could land on that the C-5 can't at the 3,000-foot level, we've looked at some work and said, well, many of these runways don't have the ability to withstand the loads that either of the aircraft would put on them, so this is not really material. But you get a program, it gets ahead of steam, ma'am, and you get this thing going, and it's hard to get it back in order. Now, there is a process ongoing in the department right at this time to take a look at all of these options and review this entire situation, and I, you know, hopefully that'll get done this summer, and it'll get done before Congress has to make a decision on whether or not to appropriate funds for the next lot of these airplanes, and there'll be a debate to these matters, and it should get resolved at that point.
I yield to Mrs. Brown.
Thank you. I just have one quick question. It seems as if we've spent $6 billion. We need to spend at least $2 more billion, and we have four planes. I need to know what we need to do as far as, do we need to stop this program at this point? Do we need to put it on hold? It seems like, I mean, that's a lot of money where I come from.
We think you got to put it on hold, at least with respect to not awarding Lot 4 and not awarding Lot 5, and these are followed until the Defense Department does what we call a total economic review of the situation. Again, that is the minimum you have to do, and because of this thing this you're talking about, you shouldn't describe, though, only four airplanes for $6 billion. That includes all of the money to design and develop this airplane, which is a significant improvement in many respects over existing airplanes. But the difficulty one has to consider here is you're looking to have a cargo kind of carrying vehicle, a truck. You want an airplane that's easy to maintain, doesn't take a lot of man hours per flight hour, and that can be done in peacetime, can carry big loads, and is kind of cheap to operate. You're not looking for high performance, high tech in the usual sense of the word, and I think we ended up with something where the technology ended up costing us too much, But those issues are being debated over in the department right now.
What we recommended in one of our previous audit reports was that they do a cost and operational effectiveness analysis that addresses the type of questions you're asking. Is this still the most cost-effective way for the department to proceed? And one of the key factors there is with the increased cost of the C-17 programs, whether it's affordable. And as part of that, we recommended that they do an affordability assessment to say, can we afford this aircraft? Even if these features are desirable, can we afford to procure this aircraft, or should we look at other alternatives?
I want to know, but we've spent $6 billion. So I want to know at the end of this, what do we have? Just the research and design?
And as of this time, the...
And four planes.
The four aircraft and the test articles.
And we'll receive a couple more, but the indications are that the contractor intends to make substantial claims in addition, and that'll be a contentious issue between the government and the contractor with respect. So we're not... My projection is that you're not going to see six flying airplanes for the $6.6 billion that is the ceiling price of this contract. Eventually, somebody's got to pay, there'll be a lot of difficulties. The estimates here range, and this is what we talked about, estimates at completion, and they're using understated estimates of completion in 1990. I've seen an estimate as high as $9.2 billion to execute that contract. I think that's well on the high side at the present time, but estimates in the range certainly of $8 billion are not in the high side.
And for $8 billion, what will we have?
You'll have six, six flying airplanes.
I thought the contract was for 122.
No, the program is for 120 airplanes. It started off. Let me give you some other examples, ma'am. This program started off in the early when it was first conceived to buy 210 airplanes for about $35 billion. Program cost. Today, the plan is to buy about 120 airplanes for about $35 billion cost. So we cut the number of airplanes nearly in half, and now we're talking about the same level of total resources going into as we started this thing here about 7-8 years ago. Now, in addition, there's great doubt of whether the $35 billion is necessarily a good estimate, although I'm not prepared to say it's not.
Okay. Gentlelady from New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A great deal of the testimony today was on the actions of three generals in the Air Force. And as I was told by your staff, they have refused to testify. And I'd like to read into the record their names: Lieutenant General Edward P. Barry, former C-17 Program Executive Officer; Major General Michael Butko, former C-17 Program Manager; and Major General John M. Nosef, former Deputy Chief of Staff of the Air Force Systems Command. And I feel that they should testify and speak for themselves as to the allegations of mismanagement, knowingly not following two laws on notice by the federal government, on alleged intimidation, on alleged mismanagement. In addition, other individuals have been identified by the IG in their testimony today, two senior Defense Department officials who oversaw Air Force procurement, Mr. Michael Donnelly, Assistant Secretary of the Air Force, Ms. Eleanor Spector, Deputy of Defense Procurement, and I request, Mr. Chairman, that you subpoena these witnesses if they will not come and respect the request of a congressional committee to explain why over $500 million was allocated when by law they were not supposed to allocate this money. And I feel that it is incumbent upon us, especially when we are looking at new taxes and new things in government, that we manage the dollars that we have more efficiently and better, and that we receive some type of explanation for this alleged multi-million dollar mismanagement of government funds. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. McCandless.
Congressman Horn had to leave to go to the Rules Committee because of an amendment that he hopes will be accepted. He asked me if I would ask this question for him, with your permission, Mr. Chairman. He doesn't understand why you did not provide the Air Force with an opportunity to comment on your report prior to its release. He's evidently had quite a bit of experience in this field, and he says the government auditing standards that apply to all federal government inspector generals state that a report should include the pertinent views of responsible officials. The question is, why didn't you give the Air Force an opportunity to comment? And then he says, is this unusual?
It's not unusual in this situation. First of all, this is not an audit report. We do, and always, almost without exception, follow the audit standard and do get comments on audit reports. This is what I would refer to as an administrative investigation, an administrative inquiry. We tend on administrative inquiry work, and I've got a special organization that generally does this, but in this particular case, the auditors did this because the auditors had all the backup material and all the information. We had done, as I discussed this morning here, three or four other audits involving these matters that we're talking about. The auditors did this special administrative inquiry, this administrative investigation, and provided it to the Air Force for their comment, if they see the comment, or for their administrative corrective action. And that's the way we normally do business in these matters. We think we get our facts right. We don't see any need to debate, and it's in the Air Force's hand to take the corrective action.
Let me follow up on that with another question. Your report, as I understand it, concluded that the Air Force knowingly engaged in secret delivery of unjustified funds to McDonnell Douglas. So my question to you would be, do you believe that this bailout scheme reached into the office of the Secretary of Defense or those under his direct command, such as the office of the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition or the office of the Director of Defense Procurement?
I'm glad you asked that question, because we looked at that matter very, very carefully, and we could find nothing from all of the witness interviews, from any of the paperwork that we could obtain supporting this, that anyone in the Office of the Secretary of Defense, to include the Director of Defense Procurement or the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition, said anything but follow the rules, et cetera. They received some briefings that put a lot of smoke and fog, over the subject to some degree. And also, there's a comment I saw that Ms. Spector made here, where she said she was unaware. I think her testimony was in 1991. You have to straighten me out. May of 91, but I don't recall when exactly it was, where the question was asked of her, are you aware of any unusual or strange progress payments or other things going to McDonnell Douglas? This was when she was testifying on the A-12 problem. The A-12 program was abruptly canceled for much the same kinds of problems in terms of reporting difficulties that the C-17 here has. And she answered that question. She was not aware. And I believe her answer was truthful. We've looked at that in some detail. I do not believe she was referring to anything with respect to the A-12, and I do not believe she was aware of this business that was going on in terms of making unusual payments or based on an estimated completion that was knowingly not a good estimate for completion at the time this happened.
In December of 1990, on page 88 of your statement, before I forget about it, did you find that date?
Yes.
The aircraft P-6 under the contract modification negotiated in September 1990 was supposed to deliver in March of 1992. By this juncture, we should have been awaiting delivery of the 16th aircraft by this point in time.
March of 1992, had the original contract been lived up to?
Well, this is the modified. This isn't even the original contract. This was the September 1990 modification.
I thought I said original when I asked.
I don't have the original delivery schedule with us. We can put that into the record.
That goes back about a year before that.
On December 10th, and I think this is an interesting, and I'd like to get you, because it's a part of your statement here, that the Director of Defense Systems and Programs Office, in so many words, felt that there was indications that all was not going well in the final assembly, and of the T-1, I'm quoting here from your report, that the Director of Defense Systems and Programs Office, in so many words, felt that there was indications that all was not going well in the final assembly. And of the T-1, I'm quoting here from your report, and the subsequent production aircraft. Now, the memorandum also noted that the officer of responsibility had repeatedly denied members of the director's staff access to the facility to review the T-1 assembly complete certification. I find that kind of interesting. I need some expansion on that. I think it's important.
I do also. I find that, you know, the Office of the Secretary of Defense is not exercising its authority when it should. We had this very same problem in the A-12 situation. Here we in the A. Let me go back just a minute to explain that, because it's the second time this has happened and it bothers us. In the A-12 situation, they were going to assemble this aircraft at a facility in Oklahoma. This same specialist, who's an engineer and his background, I guess, mechanical engineering, production engineering, went to that facility, issued a report, which I to this day believe, had it got to the attention of the Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition, might have changed the whole tenor of what happened on the A-12. That report was passed up the chain and got thrown away. He went and said, gee, this place isn't really even ready to assemble A-12 airplanes, much less, you know, we're not going to meet any kind of dates. It got tossed away. In this particular case, the same individual had some inklings, I believe, that, wait a minute, this T-1 aircraft was really not complete and not assembled. He wanted to go to the plant and look. He requested to do so, and he was denied access to the plant. Now, that is intolerable, to have the Undersecretary of Defense's acquisition staff be denied access to these facilities to do their job.
And he did not pursue a course of action which would have given him access, to the best of your knowledge?
Sir, what he did was he did elevate the matter. He did elevate it in December of 1990, but before it was resolved, the Air Force had accepted the aircraft.
Mr. Chairman, I don't want to take any more of the committee's time, which is left up to you and I, but I would ask unanimous consent that I be able to ask in writing questions of the Inspector General, for which I hope he would be amenable in answering.
Without objection, so ordered.
In layman's language, so that an old fender bender type guy could understand.
We thank you very much. Do you have any observations that concluding that you'd like to add?
Well, I don't know. We, I think we've caught most of the business. Questions have to be asked by the Congress here as this goes along with respect to, you know, the cost issue, which, you know, which I discussed a little, I believe, with Ms. Brown and Ms. Maloney. But that's certainly, there's more to be said about that. You know, the cost, it is, to me, it gotten to the point of near ridiculousness. As I was saying to myself here, we were, not very many years ago, we could buy a squadron of F-16s for the price of one of these airplanes. Now, you know, and this isn't the leading edge. This isn't going to be we got to get there, but we can get there with 141s, and there's a lot of alternatives to this that need to be considered very closely. In addition, there are some technical problems that we're not totally astute to, so I'm not going to talk to, but they deal with such issues as the blown flaps, and I think the committee's aware of that, whether redesign has to take place there. You've still got the strengthening of the wing issue for those wings that have already been built and redesigned. You've got a technical issue with respect to the leading edge slats and when you back the aircraft up or whether there's too much heat and there's going to be difficulties, and that has to be redesigned and the aluminum replaced with titanium. So there's a lot of things to be concerned with and things to be considered. I really believe the Department of Defense has got the message and is looking at this in a serious sort of way at this point. It's unfortunate that it has to go to this point because a lot of these alarm bells and this DPRO, this Colonel Tollefson, was sending in what he called bell ringer reports regularly during the summer of 1990. You know, trying to sound the alarm, if you will, and it didn't seem that anybody wanted to pay a heck of a lot of attention, and we could have avoided some of this had we, you know, taken proper actions much earlier to bring this thing in line. And that, I guess that's the point I want to make. It's too bad we don't deal with these problems right away when we first identify them, because this was known by January of 1990. It was well known that we were facing this problem.
We're indebted to you, Mr. Vandeschaft, and your excellent staff. Thank you very much. Are the following witnesses from the Department of Defense in the hearing room: Mr. Michael B. Donnelly, Ms. Eleanor Spector, Lieutenant General Edward P. Berry, Major General Michael Butchko, Major General John M. Nassif. Since these individuals have not appeared today to provide testimony about C-17, we need to clarify the record. I ask unanimous consent to include the letter from Deputy Secretary of Defense William J. Perry in the record at this time. Last Congress, the subcommittee conducted two oversight hearings on C-17. We received testimony concerning a series of questionable actions in late 1990 by Defense to provide unusual financial support to McDonnell Douglas, the prime contractor for the C-17. Because these actions raised such questions, on February 21 of last year, I asked the Department of Defense Inspector General to conduct a comprehensive review as a part of the subcommittee's ongoing investigation. On January 14 of this year, the subcommittee received the IG's report on this review entitled Government Actions Concerning McDonnell Douglas Corporation Financial Condition During 1990. The Inspector General report concluded that Air Force officials had taken actions in connection with the funding of the C-17, which resulted in potential violations of statutes and acquisition regulations. Shortly after receiving that report on January 21 of this year, I wrote the Secretary of Defense to request that the Air Force officials identified in the Inspector General report appear and testify before this subcommittee today. Specifically, I requested the testimony from Lieutenant General Berry, Major General Butchko, Major General Nassif. In addition to those individuals who had been identified by the Inspector General, I requested the testimony of two senior defense officials who oversaw Air Force procurement including C-17. They were Mr. Michael Donnelly and Ms. Eleanor Spector. These requests were very carefully drawn and intended to elicit testimony from those individuals who were most directly implicated in the questionable actions relating to the C-17 program. Each of these witnesses was personally involved in actions relating to the C-17, and I believe that their testimony is necessary to complete the subcommittee's investigation. We received no response to this request for witnesses until March 8th, when the Defense Department suggested that other witnesses appear and testify at our hearing today. The department cited no legal basis for refusing to provide the witnesses requested. I immediately replied to Defense Secretary Aspin that the witnesses I had identified were needed if this committee is to effectively execute its legislative and oversight responsibilities. I also expressed my willingness to consider receiving testimony from any other additional witnesses that the Defense Department might wish to suggest. 1 week later, on March 15, the subcommittee had received no response to this offer or any further explanation of the Defense Department's actions. I therefore once again wrote to Secretary Aspin, reiterating our need for these witnesses and requesting that the Defense Department cite any authority which permitted it to refuse to produce these witnesses. Yesterday, I received a letter from Deputy Secretary of Defense, Mr. Perry, which I've already put in the record, which, while providing no legal authority for withholding testimony, did set out two reasons for the department's resistance. One, we do not, quote, we do not believe that it would be fair to direct individuals who are under consideration for disciplinary action to participate in a hearing to answer questions on the same conduct for which they could be disciplined. And two, he believed that the Department of Defense should be permitted to conclude its review and arrive at its response to the recommendation for discipline without subjecting that process to the pressures of a congressional committee hearing, end quotation. Subcommittee members Curtis Collins, Glenn English, Steve Neal, Tom Lantos, Carolyn Maloney, and Corrine Brown have joined in with me in signing a letter which responded to these assertions. And as we explained, we know of no legal authority indicating that the possibility of disciplinary action is a basis for a department refusing to produce an employee who can provide relevant testimony to a congressional oversight hearing. In addition, we pointed out that presenting the truth at a subcommittee hearing would not or should not interfere with the Department of Defense decision-making process in any way. We further explained that congressional oversight cannot be suspended whenever disciplinary action is recommended by an inspector general. And finally, we urged the department to reconsider its position and produce the requested witnesses here today. And it appears that despite these extraordinary efforts to secure cooperation by the Defense Department, there has been no change in its position. Under the Constitution, the Congress serves as a check on the activities and spending of the executive branch. As the Chief Oversight Committee of the House of Representatives, the Committee on Government Operations and this subcommittee play critical roles in securing information from the executive branch so that the Congress can make informed judgments about federal programs. Despite our repeated inquiries, the Department of Defense has provided no legal authority for its refusal to produce witnesses who can provide relevant testimony to an ongoing investigation. Under the circumstances, If the subcommittee is to effectively discharge its responsibilities to Congress and the American people, I believe that we must consider invoking compulsory process. It is neither pleasant nor desirable a way for us to begin oversight of the Department of Defense in a new administration. And I am, of course, fully prepared to consider any reasonable accommodation to avoid an unnecessary confrontation. I can assure the subcommittee and every member on it that I will personally be available to discuss any Defense Department proposal in this connection. I do not believe, however, that we can accept the Defense Department's legally baseless refusal to produce witnesses and still function in any meaningful way as an oversight committee. I am also sensitive to the health circumstances surrounding the Secretary of Defense and will take them into full accommodations in my consultations with Mr. McCandless. Since we have already scheduled a hearing for Tuesday, March 23, 1993 at 10 a.m., we will consider, unless something occurs between now and then, the issuance of subpoenas on Wednesday morning, March 24th at 10 a.m. Chair recognizes the ranking Republican member, Mr. McCandless.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have the letter before me, which you asked unanimous consent to include in the record, and I have no objection. You have quoted from that record, from this letter in your statement. I would simply add that in this letter, Secretary Aspin has expressed his concern over the report and has asked the Air Force to provide recommendations to the Undersecretary, or the gentleman in question, William Perry, who is a Deputy Secretary of Defense, and that these recommendations would be available by the 20th of April. And that they would include a proposed response to the Inspector General's recommendation for disciplinary action. I think that probably is the gist of the letter from the Deputy Secretary of Defense to you, dated 16th of March. I mention this, Mr. Chairman, because it would not appear to me that the Deputy Secretary or the Secretary of Defense are dragging their feet in any way, because they continue to say that once that has been that information has been acquired, they are anxious to assist the committee in exercising the responsibility and would make whatever availability available.
The chair calls William Jenny. Please stand and raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony that you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jenny. Please be seated. We're delighted to find out that you could travel from California to Washington without incident. We accept your statement into the record, and you may proceed in your own way.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me get my statement out.
Mr. Jay, these are directional microphones, so when you get all of that set up, if you could pull that a little closer, it would help me in what I have left of my hearing.
I've got the same problem. Well, Mr. Chairman, thank you for asking me here today for this committee to discuss the situation at the Douglas Company in the first half of 1990. I will make a brief opening statement and ask that my full statement be included in the record. Is this not loud enough? In summary, my full statement will show the following. One, Douglas Aircraft had increasingly severe cost and schedule problems during 1986-1990 time period on all their major programs. Two, by May 1990, internal company cost estimates indicated the C-17 was headed for a huge $1.2 to $2.1 billion overrun. This was never disclosed to the general investing public or the United States Air Force in 1990 in any McDonnell Douglas financial report. MDC, McDonnell Douglas, chose to use an estimate they described, quote, at or near break even, unquote, implying no profit nor any loss when they knew or should have known of the inadequacies of the estimates. The question is whether a reasonably prudent, publicly owned company would have taken that course of action in the same circumstances. And I don't think they would. I retired from McDonnell Douglas in June 1988 with 27 years of experience. While an employee, I held various positions, such as Director of Operations Control, Director of DC-10 Program Planning and Control, Director of Major Subcontracts, and Director of MD-11 Operations Control. When I left in June 1988, the T-45 Navy trainer was badly overrun and badly behind schedule. C-17 engineering drawing releases averaged 6 to 9 months late to schedule. MD-11 critical machine parts were forecasted to be over 36 weeks late to their scheduled assembly start date. MD-80 assembly man hours per airplane had almost doubled compared to that level for that same type of work done in 1985. Matter of fact, by 1989, they ran up to and slightly over 100,000 man hours per airplane. In January 1990, I went back to Douglas on a contract basis as a contract hire and went to work for Mr. R.A. Bybee, who was the then Vice President of Fiscal. My job assignment was to develop an independent cost estimating and pricing function reporting to Mr. Bybee. He had some concerns about the quality and accuracy of the financial forecasts and cost of sales estimates provided by the various program offices for use in the financial statements. And at this time, there did not exist an independent check and balance function in fiscal. That more or less was given way during the February 1989 reorganization. Once we had the function organized and staffed, we began to look into the cost and schedule status of the three major programs, the MD-80, the MD-11, and the C-17. The MD-11 assembly cost and schedule status was the first review that we made. In summary, we found that the 1990 operating plan estimates at completion, which had been put together in November, December of the prior year, but for 1990, were already overrun on four airplanes in process, and the others in process would greatly exceed the planned learning curve cost reduction per unit. The review results indicated a potential overrun on the first 50 aircraft of $486 million and another $675 million on the following 251 aircraft, which was the accompaniment of their 301 airplane pool for accounting purposes. Then we looked at the MD-80 assembly, same types of results as we found with the MD-11, not as much money involved, but the same type of thing going on. Program was a month and a half behind schedule. For example, in the month of January, 11 airplanes were scheduled for delivery, one delivered. All airplanes delivered through March of that year, 1990, had overrun their operating plan assembly budgets by 15.3% on average. And this program was supposed to be the cash cow for the company in 1990. On April 19, 1990, we completed, this cost estimating group completed a review of the C-17 assembly man hours for units then in process. Our analysis showed that the first airplane, known as T-1, was 35% complete, but had expended 62.2% of the funds at completion when compared to the 1990 operating plan estimates at completion, and therefore most likely would suffer an overrun of about 1.2 million hours when it was finally complete. The first production unit, the next unit in the flow, known as Production 1 or P1, was 17% complete, but had expended, much like the first airplane, almost twice as much money as it had in percent of completedness. And therefore, we assumed, or we extrapolated from that, that the operating plan estimate of completion for that aircraft would probably overrun by 750,000 man-hours at completion. These estimates then extrapolated through the first seven aircraft using a 75% learning curve, which is a fairly nominal industry standard learning curve unit reduction. That extrapolation, and again using that 75% learning curve, indicated an overrun potential of about 6 million man hours at completion, or 385 million on those aircraft. These forecasts excluded the static and durability test units, which would add to that overrun. We just didn't have the data to work with them at that time. The results of all three of these reviews were sent to my superior, Mr. Bybee, by memo, and they are included today as part of my full statement. During this time period, a retired fiscal vice president at Douglas had been hired to help the company develop the financial data needed to produce subsequent years' bidding rates for submittal and approval to the government. The quality of the financial data flowing into this effort from the various program offices was so bad that this vice president took his concerns to the senior management council that met every evening at about 4:30 in the evenings to ask for an independent review of all estimates. A group of financial experts from St. Louis, the corporate offices in St. Louis, were brought in to conduct the review. Their review was completed and findings presented in the first week of May 1990. They concluded that all three programs had major cost and schedule problems and would have serious negative cash flow consequences, which was pretty important to them. I had a chance to read their findings after having been interviewed by them and so forth, but I was not allowed to keep a copy. Now, interestingly enough, during this same period, this late April, early May time period, the C-17 program manager, the C-17 business manager, and the fiscal vice president, Mr. Bybee, were relieved. The deputy president, Mr. Capolupo, was named the new program manager. A corporate review team member was named the new C-17 business manager. And Mr. Bybee was replaced by Mr. Perkle, who had been vice president of product center operations at Douglas, which is the parts manufacturer end of the business. In early May 1990, the C-17 business manager and my group were directed by Mr. Perkle to do a complete re-estimate of the C-17 program costs. This was done and the results recapped on a recap dated May 18, 1990. That recap, which is part of my full statement, indicated much higher estimates for the 2108 contract estimates at completion than had been formally recognized at any time prior to that. And just briefly, to give you an idea of what they were, The C-17 estimate at completion done by their fiscal people from the program office came out to $7.7 billion at completion, again for the 2108 contract. The fiscal estimate came out to $8.6 billion, and then we were asked to get together for sake of teamwork and that type of thing in meeting with management in the future on this subject and work out a consensus of what both groups could agree to as a possible estimate at completion without giving away your total integrity on the thing. That consensus figure, again, now this was the amalgamation of the C-17 people and the fiscal people, came out to $8.2 billion. These were reviewed with Perkle, Capolupo, and other senior management personnel during the next several weeks. A decision was made to cut back all C-17 costs, primarily labor, and to budget all remaining costs to stay within the $6.461 billion estimate at completion. Now that level is important because that's the level that they had been using in their financial statements up to and through the second quarter of 1990 for the C-17 at completion. Direct actions were initiated in late May to quantify the required reductions in force and set a timetable for execution. And I believe everybody in this room knows that the ensuing labor force reductions are now well in the public record. I was not present at any discussions as to how the company intended to treat the impact of these higher estimates in the various financial reports required by law, nor do I know what they intended to disclose to the United States Air Force or the Deep Row, if anything. However, experienced aerospace cost analysts would have seen the near impossibility of achieving the 6.461 estimate of completion. The remaining work left to complete that contract would have required productivity more than twice that of previously completed labor effort. Now, that, a little parenthetically in here, that's what I call a con job, and we used to get that quite often at Douglas from the doing functions. In assembly, for example, 1.65 hours or 99 minutes had actually been spent for each completed budget hour through the end of May. To meet the assembly hours, the remaining assembly hours, and stay within the $6.461 billion budget, only 7/10 of an hour or 42 minutes could be spent on each remaining budget hour. So it's 42 minutes left to spend versus 99 having actually been spent. Interesting thing about that is that all past assembly cost history at Douglas clearly showed that the further an airplane progresses towards completion, actual man hours spent are less cost productive, not more. McDonnell Douglas knew or should have known of the inadequacy of the $6.461 billion estimate at completion used for the second quarter of 1990 financial statements. Their cost savings initiatives notwithstanding, no well-run aerospace company could have attained the production learning curves assumed in that estimate, let alone McDonnell Douglas. And finally, I have never testified to Congress before, nor do I find any, you know, real delight in doing so today. My appearance is solely as an American who has witnessed with contempt the arrogant, incompetent, unethical management of the McDonnell Douglas Company during the 1988-1990 time period. Their breaches of fiduciary responsibility for honest financial reporting to both the general investing public and tax-supported agencies such as the Department of Defense should not go uncensored. I should be glad to take any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Jenny, for your statement. Mr. McCandless.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Jenny, I feel a need to ask this, and it's not meant to be derogatory, but why are you appearing to testify today? What motivation do you have for this?
Well, I think I stated on the final few paragraphs that, you know, notwithstanding I had been a McDonnell Douglas employee and so forth, I am an American, I am a taxpayer, and I felt like appearing.
Thank you. I appreciate your answer. In your statement, you indicate that any experienced and knowledgeable aerospace engineer would have seen the impossibility of meeting McDonald's projected 55% leaning curve, mm-hmm. learning curve, excuse me. what was the C-17's actual learning curve in the spring of 1990? Where, in your estimation, should
you, you had airplanes in process. You had T-1 airplane. The next one coming was the P-1 airplane, first production airplane. Then you had a static and durability right thereafter. None of those were complete. So you had no established actual learning curve yet. The one that we use for projection purposes was a 75% learning curve. It assumed an estimate of completion at T1 of 3 million man hours, and then for every unit doubled as you come down that learning curve, that doubled unit would be 75% of the unit it was doubled from. That's what you mean by a 75% learning curve. I'll give you an example. If T1 were 100 hours. A doubled unit from one then is two. Then two would be 75% of the first airplane, T1, 75% of 100 hours, it'd make it a 75-hour airplane. And then number four would be 75% of number two, and number eight would be 75% of number four. That's, it's simplistically, that's a learning. So what we assumed a 75% slope on our estimates that went into the $8.6 billion estimate of completion.
Your statement includes a May 9th C-17 assembly man hour status report. That chart provides figures showing budgeted assembly hours, projected hours at EAC, and the number and percent of actual hours spent on production as of May 1990. Mm-hmm. For somebody like myself, what do these numbers mean, and how do they show an impossible, unrealistic assembly schedule for the C-17?
Sir, are you referring to this chart?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Importance of this document here is it was the first status sheet published to the management on the C-17 program after we had received instructions to rebudget everything and not go above the 6.4 level. The man hours in the first column called budgeted hours, note two, are budget to production assembly based on May 1990 Hayden rebaseline budget. And that's exactly what I meant when I said everything had to be redone to the 6.4 billion estimate level. So these were the estimates at completion for the first aircraft, first production aircraft, static unit, durability unit, and the second production unit. The next column speaks of actual hours. Now those are the hours incurred cumulatively through the end of May 1990 on each of those airplanes as shown. The next column is percent spent, and that's simply taking the actual hours, let's take T1 there as an example, of 1,221,000 hours and dividing it by the 2 million budget at completion, man hours at completion, you get 61%. So you know how much you've spent of your budget. The clincher, though, comes in the fourth column called percent complete. Now that percent complete is a engineered time standard value for all of the work to build any one of these airplanes. Now, as the work progresses and the workers get them cleared through quality inspection and so forth, they're what we call bought off and aggregated. So that out of a, say, 100,000-hour standard airplane, if they have 40,000 standard hours completed, the jobs adding up to 40,000 that have been completed, then they'd be, against a 100,000-hour airplane, they'd be 40% complete. Now, when you're, this gets into a poor situation when you're 60% expended and only 40% complete, as measured against the new budgets that had to be met to make the company's estimate. A straight line extrapolation, simply taking your actual hours to date divided by the percent complete, gives you the last column on the right-hand side. And if you look at that and compare it to the first column, you can see the makings of a huge overrun, and a huge overrun beyond the newly directed 6.4 total, which we find later is used in their financial reporting level. So that's what I mean. It was this kind of data that clearly indicated the amount of improvement you had to make on the work remaining and the probable prospect that you weren't going to make it at all. The curve's too steep. Almost every airplane we've ever built at Douglas, the assembly on those airplanes gets less productive the further you go through to completion. So all the things that we've experienced in history in the past said, you can't do that.
Gets less productive the further you go into completion in terms of the total cost per unit.
Yeah, let's suppose you're 50% complete and you're getting a you're spending an actual hour of one for one standard hour. But when you get through to 75% complete and ultimately 100, because when you're 100% complete, everything's got to be done. There's no more tags, there's no more part short, everything's got to be done. So that one final standard hour to get you to 100% complete, rather than spending 1 hour, you might spend 1.1 or 1.15.
Go back and find the pink wire that is shorted out or something, that kind of thing.
Yeah. But rarely, almost never, would you find that 1 hour being done for 7/10 or 1/2. It's just, that's bushy-tailed dreaming.
Who in McDonnell Douglas was aware of your May 1990 C-17 work estimate? And to the best of your knowledge, how was that report used?
Well, the senior management people that I dealt with that May 18th estimate were Perkle, who was then the vice president of finance, and Capolupo, the deputy president and the C-17 program manager, newly appointed, and a fellow named Jack Hayden, who was the deputy C-17 program manager. Those three people. And we met individually and collectively several, two or three times after the creation of the May 18th estimates.
I'm going to ask you a question that is somewhat related, but it keeps coming back to me. From its concept to its production date, the P-51 in World War II was 135 days. Concept to production.
Yes.
And we have all kinds of stories like that. And one would say, yes, but current planes and aerospace equipment is far more complex. And one would have to agree to that. Conversely, you no longer use slide rules. You use computers, which also gives you an advantage in terms of number of man hours to accomplish a given mathematical equation. In your assessment of this, what's wrong with the system that we get bogged down like we have here, separate from what may or may not be legal or illegal payments, and getting something online and getting it built?
You're talking about the conduct of the management of the program, hopefully to a fruitful
I'm talking about how to order something and get it produced.
Well, I'll give you a couple thoughts. Number one, when you order something, don't order from somebody that's got two other concurrent design, major design programs going on in the same plant at the same time. That's just bound to give you trouble. Number two, when you order something from somebody, make sure I'd suggest make sure they have, one, a good, well-trained, well-experienced engineering department, and two, a proven record that they don't miss their drawing release schedules. Now, if you can do that, if you can control those drawing release schedules, you got a lot of the battle whipped. If you can stay on schedule, you got a dandy chance, barring some big technical thing that could come along, you got a dandy chance of making your estimates. But you have no chance, ever, if you fall behind schedule. It just compounds to the next succeeding function, like planning and material and fabrication, and it just gets worse and worse and worse, and it's like a whirlpool. The more you struggle, the worse it gets. You add more people, you add more overtime, still you're losing the schedule, and you keep doing it until finally, you know, you're just broke. So if you can control the front end of that schedule almost ruthlessly, you got an excellent chance. And the other point, don't put work in where they've got two other concurrent design programs.
Okay, now you may or may not want to answer this question. My understanding that the Airbus 340 is going to give our current generation and next generation of American-made planes fits, separate from what allegedly is a subsidy support on the part of the governments, because they're able to crank them out in a way that addresses what it was you were talking about in terms of number of man hours per unit produced and so on and so forth, which is was what production is all about. Yeah. Are we saying that the consortium that builds this plane is using what it is you've talked about to the maximum degree possible?
Well, are you saying that you have heard that their man hours will be lower than something we know about? Per unit, it's going to be a cheap airplane, is that what you're saying? Or short lead time, or both?
That there is greater efficiency in the production of their planes, or the latest generation of planes, than we are currently experiencing, and therefore they have not only possibly a subsidy edge from their governments, but also a production edge in terms of cost per unit.
Well, I don't know what the facts are on that, but I'd be surprised. The French, when we looked at them in the 60s on the Caravelle, for example, their hours per pound to build an airplane were like three times ours, but their labor rate was like three times less. So, you know, you had an advantage there. And I just don't know what the Airbus factors are, but just knowing them from my previous experience, I would suspect they're not going to be cheaper than where. They certainly aren't going to be cheaper than Boeing. Now, they might be cheaper than Douglas.
One more, if I may. There's a gentleman that's retired from the aerospace industry that has gathered around him a number of other gentlemen with many years, like yourself, of experience. Mm-hmm. And he created a company in California and has recently moved it to Ohio. And there was an article in the Post this weekend about this gentleman whose last name is Snow. Mm-hmm. The objective of this company is to build an air freighter. And they're talking about the success of this centering around the fact that everybody involved has got 25 to 35 to 40 years experience in one of the leading manufacturers of airframes. Yeah. And that they're not taking any salary, and that this is a labor of love, so to speak. That they're going to be able to put these freighters out, which are designed to take cargo containers, those such as come from ships, for something like $10 million a copy. Now, if this gentleman has the experience that was reported, and all these people have the experience that was reported in terms of building planes, and you, with your experience in building planes, is this a theoretically possible thing to do if the government stays out of it and doesn't get involved?
Well, I don't know about the government, per se, but having experience, you know, is going to help. Having a small company is going to help. You're not larded down with the inordinate amount of bureaucracy and staff people and human resources and big computing and all that. You just go get the job done. That always helped. Matter of fact, I thought you were going to talk about the company that McGowan had, the ex-president Douglas. He formed mid-70s, and I went to work for him for 7 years, re-engineering DC-8s to, you know, comply with stage two noise levels. Mm-hmm. And we had a great program going on. Every guy, I was a youngster, I think I was 50 when I started. The rest of them were, you know, 68, 69, vice president, plant managers of the Douglas Company, Lockheed. We had well-experienced, well-educated fellows from all other roar, you know, which was very important because of their nacelle history and so forth. We did quite well. We didn't sell as many as we wanted. The design was beautiful. We screwed up and put the work, though, to re-engine the airplanes in Tulsa, McDonnell Douglas, Tulsa, and it cost us all a lot. But I think the thing you're describing, and I don't know about $10 million, but can happen. I've seen some wonderful things done with experienced people and damn small staffs and a dedication. That counts a lot.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Okay.
Well, thank you very much for your questions. Mr. Jenny, you're a great American. We thank you for coming. I've got some questions for you.
All right.
Any final observations, Mr. McCandless?
No, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I have a closing statement that I ask be inserted in the record. We've been looking at this for 2 years. We've found design weaknesses. And with the Inspector General, we've unraveled a complex plan to bail out the manufacturer. We know now that the C-17 program is technically flawed. We know now that its financing system is flawed. We know that costs are out of control and probably escalating. We suspect that efficiency is deteriorating. And we think that sworn statements made to this subcommittee may be contrary to the evidence. And therefore, we're going to continue this hearing tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. We thank you for coming. Subcommittee stands adjourned.
This was the first of two hearings the House Government Operations Subcommittee is holding to assess the construction of the C-17 transport plane. There have been reports of cost overruns, design flaws, and mismanagement of the project. The Congressional Budget Office estimates that each C-17 will cost $240 million. Our companion public affairs network, C-SPAN, will cover the second day of hearings Thursday morning. If you'd like to find out the exact time, call our C-SPAN schedule information hotline. The telephone number is area code 202-628-2205. That's 202-628-2205. If you have any comments on the hearing you just saw, write to the House Government Operations Subcommittee on National Security. The address is B373 Rayburn House Office Building in Washington, D.C. The zip code is 20515. You're watching C-SPAN.